That's Tom Petty looking for some Barry Trader.
Chuck Berry song.
He's gonna find it.
Barry Trader, here's something in a can. It's the Bennington Show. One day before the last day before Christmas break. Which seems strange.
That happened fast.
It was a fast year.
So this was 2015.
Yeah, and now it's done.
You know, it doesn't seem that long ago that we were over at Stinkin' Center trying to figure out how we were going to put this show together. And I remember, I believe it was Gail who said this. I'm like, you know, it's a brand new show. We're putting together. We got some old, some new. I go, I don't know how to tie this thing together. And I remember what you said to me.
What was that?
Well, you were looking off into the distance outside of Stinkin' Center. And you actually said this. Joey, JoJo. And I go, what? And then you said,
Joey, JoJo.
With us?
Yeah. He's perfect for the new show.
Joe?
Yeah.
But doesn't he always wear stupid Christmas sweaters? And doesn't he have glasses?
Ew.
Yeah. We need that. We need that type. That's what we're missing. That it factor.
He is tech savvy. So then I go, okay, I guess that's everything we need. And then I remember Chris burped, but it sounded like,
Vito.
And I'm like, excuse me?
Fuck you.
He goes, I just burped. Because that was more than a burp. It was brilliant. You burped Vito. Subconsciously, you want Vito with us. And now look at us here at the end of the year, having a great Christmas.
Wonderful.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. By the way, Chris Stanley knows what happens. Now, you did... You talked to the hospital.
Yes.
And I told him to not tell me until we got on the air. Because I thought that would be, you know, the interesting angle of it. By the way, picture up of Fez on the iBang with his new lover. You know what? This is, for me, a Christmas miracle. So it's up on the Interbank today, just seeing Fez with his new lover. First of all, shocking, but also comforting.
I'm so happy for him.
Yeah.
I'm so happy for him.
I would be, except for Joe's here and he doesn't have anyone this Christmas.
Oh, true.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Joe.
Oh, Joe.
Hey.
What are you guys talking about?
I was just thinking about Christmas Eve, and if you're not busy, why not third wheel it with us?
Yeah.
If you get the chance.
You mean I can be that training wheel for you guys?
Yeah, I guess, on one side anyway.
Sure, wobbly.
Mm-hmm. But that'd be great.
I'll do it.
Shit. I just wanted to say... It's Christmas, Lumber Bay Treasure.
Again.
Gotta get that name out there.
Again. It was more consistent than Tom Petty. Just great song after great song after great song.
No one. That's it. That's the answer.
I had to take him and throw him in the Foo Fighters' faces. And say, hey, now deal with that.
Screw you, Grohl.
Right in their foo faces.
Why did Army Man get mad at Grohl?
He always shows up.
Us with your hair, your beard, your bands.
I never saw Army Man turn so negative. He's normally a positive guy.
Need more Petty up in here.
Well, he follows the mob, so that must be what everyone else was thinking.
Army Man has never had an original thought.
No. He goes with the crowd.
What do you guys think? Yeah!
What do you guys think?
Because I agree with your unformed thoughts. Let's start this up.
It's Christmas over. All right, let's play this. Give me Fez's new lover. The picture's up on the iBank. Let's do a 1 to 10. What would you give Fez's new lover?
Wow. I feel like a good solid 7.5.
Wow.
And I think that's great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Good solid 7.5.
I think it's just cool to see Fez with his shirt off.
I love it.
Yeah. Nice to see your back. I like you, yeah. I don't know why that can't catch on more, but it was always the thing to say to somebody with a backless dress. Nice to see your back. Get it? Girl. No one fucking gets that. And what do you give number wise?
I can only go to 10.
Yeah.
Because it should be a 12, because this is serious.
I hate when someone tries to ruin your thing.
10.
10.
Yeah. 10 is enough. 10. This is
max. Max.
You mean a Fez 10, right? Like, not like
not a real life
standard.
Yeah, it's
10.
Definitely a Fez 10. Joey Jojo.
I don't have enough fingers to give it enough fingers, so I'm using cashmere's. And mine, and we're giving it a 20.
See, they ruined the fucking structure of this.
10. It's a 10.
10 is the best thing you
can
do.
Learn from my mistakes.
Sorry.
I'm going to give an East German 3. You know what I mean? I know
yeah, why not?
I know you guys are too young to remember the East German vote.
No.
But when the Americans would skate, you'd see like 6.5, 6.6, 6.7, 2.1. The East Germans would just be like fucking making sure that the Russians won. And the East German vote was like, and everybody in America would scream like they didn't know, they hadn't seen this happen a million fucking times.
They were aware of the Cold War, right?
I'm That's like, really who cares funny. Who wins? You get a chance to skate and express yourself.
And did America short
Wait
on the Russians?
No, we never did that. We're the fucking red, white, and blue. We're Superman. Wait a minute, I just thought of something wonderful. If we turn cashmere into a figure skater,
oh,
we could make that paper.
My God.
You know what I mean?
That bank.
Yeah, we'll make that bank.
Those coins.
Yeah, we'll get those coins. Cashmere, you skate at all?
The only time I've skated is with the New Jersey Devils.
What?
Wait, what?
Then he does this.
I'm like, are they still popular? I have no clue.
Yes, they're very popular right now. All the kids are talking
they're
about
it. So hot. Right?
Devils
right
are in, yeah.
Talk
yeah,
Jersey.
It's devil time.
It's devil time.
Since the Nets left, that's all I have. Yeah.
So why, let's try to figure out, were you a goalie? What were you doing? Your one-time skating.
Enforcer. This guy was knocking motherfuckers out. I mean, they brought him in to go into the penalty
the
box.
They used to call him guys with a hammer.
It was, I won a raffle skating with them, and I got to bring 3 best friends, and we went on down to the rink.
But you don't know how to skate.
Not at all. So they carried, it was like a dream. Like they just they walked me around the ice.
Who did? The
I think like a Brodeur. Brodeur? Is that like the goalie guy?
So wait, you had a professional fucking hockey player grab you by and carry you around. You said it was like a dream, rather than being humiliating.
Not, yeah,
now we know which figure skater he'll be.
Yeah.
He's going to be up in the air a lot.
Oh, yeah, I'm the yeah.
Yeah.
All throws.
Yeah, we'll be tossing
Do not let
you
him touch the ice. Yeah, yeah.
This is pretty amazing. It looks like he hasn't touched the ice yet. Look at those blades. Completely dry.
All for show. It's all for show. They're bedazzled blades. Yeah.
All right. So this could be interesting. We could have the first guy who is nothing but tossed and carried. It looks like we're going to make that paper.
Them coins.
That bank.
Why do you do this with your hands?
Because it's fun. That bank. Make sure everyone knows.
He does do these hands a lot.
A lot of people make it rain. I just let it drop.
Speaking of rain, because it rained, it looks like Chris cut his hair.
Looks great.
Thanks. Yesterday, I did not take a shower. Just dunking my head in water.
I don't want to hear about that, Chris. Okay. Just let it pass. I knew that you were wearing the incredibly wrinkled clothes from the night before.
Yes.
Yeah. That was rough.
You were wearing your egg cream pants still.
All right. We're going to get into having Stanley tell his what happened story. Before that, Kardashian ass up on the Interrobang as well. But it's not the ass that you would expect. Is it the oldest one? The
Is it Courtney's?
Courtney's.
Yeah. Yes.
Courtney's ass. Is that kind of shocking? Because she's the mom for...
She's definitely known for having the least large ass between the three of them.
But it's well-paved.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's stunningly well-paved.
Oh, it's an Instagram shot. That's smart.
Oh, yeah.
She put it up on her own gram.
Oh, wow.
Excuse me?
It's very muscular.
It's pretty cute, though.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And she was smart enough to throw in some side teat.
Oh, that's very sexy.
Oh, just yeah.
Just a titty popping out.
No, the way that she has her one leg wrapped around the other, is that to accentuate glute muscles?
Yeah, so it's that, and see how her back is. She's jacking it up a little bit.
Smart move, okay.
And she's kind of...
The gals know.
Yeah.
I wonder if guys look like they have such flat asses because they don't know those things. They don't have heels.
Right.
You know?
I mean, if you roll your back the opposite direction, it's going to look much flatter.
Yeah. Now, here's the thing, too. And it'll show you that the Kardashians are very tanned people because her ass is just about as tanned as her back or legs. You know, for being a California person.
Nice to see your back.
Nice to see your back.
Shy.
Here's what I want to do, Chris, because, look, I'm going to give it away now. I'm getting you a nice camera for Christmas.
Oh.
Now, what I want you to do, though, is ass shots with Joe.
Okay.
And I want you to start an Instagram account.
Okay.
And get Joe, look. Learn the poses. All right.
Okay. That's a good
one. He stands too flat footed, and that's why his ass doesn't look.
Joe, photo shoot after the show, and you better arch, motherfucker, because if I don't see that ass popping, I'm going to be pissed.
Yes, and sir. See, that's everything. Yeah. That's not the way you get things out of people. You're fucking Stalin instead of sitting there trying to work it.
You have to make him want to show his ass off.
Okay. Oh, okay.
You know what I mean?
You make it his fun. Idea.
I don't just bark orders at him. I just let it happen naturally, but I'm.
Yeah, romance it a little bit, Chris.
All right, work a Joey Jojo.
Garrison, you're on the show here from Wisconsin. You're on the Bennington show.
How's things going there today?
Oh, it's good.
Oh, yeah.
Real good.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. All right, good. Hey, fun fact for you guys.
Yeah.
If you have an iPhone and you type lardass, all one word, into an iPhone, it autocorrects to Kardashian.
Now, that's absolutely true.
What?
No one's been doing this to you?
No.
You don't have an iPhone, right?
No, I'm an Android boy.
All right, so watch this, Chris. So you see me typing in lardass.
Yeah.
Right? There it is, all one word. And I'm going to send it to Gail. Wait, why doesn't it work like that?
Oh, shit!
There it is.
It just goes to Kardashians. Now, here's the thing. This isn't new. It's been for years, but I guess a lot of people don't have any reason to make lardass one word.
Lardass. 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 Lardass.
Ma'am. I bet the Kardashians love that.
Oh, yeah. It's great.
It's branding.
I also found out that when I was texting something to you the other day, I wanted to tell you something about Joe, and I said I was leading up to something about Joe, and it auto-corrected immediately to Joe Montana.
Nice.
So I said something like Joe recut the scene, the Tito's thing, but it said Joe Montana did it, and I have no idea why. I have no idea why the assumption was Joe Montana's on this. He's taking care of it.
Have you written Joe Montana before? Because normally if they find out, it's like if you write anything a lot, it'll just assume that you're going that direction. So you must be sitting around thinking about the 80s 49ers, talking with your pals about it a lot more than you think.
It pops up. Look, right here.
Old Smokey Joe Cool.
Joe Montana is the first thing that pops up.
That's fucking hilarious.
Joe Namath must be pissed.
He's the definitive Joe.
Molly, he's got four times the rings that Joe Namath has.
At least the iPhones in the Northeast, it should be Joe Namath. I mean, West Coast, sure, I get it.
You know what? Joe Montana's from the Pittsburgh area, much like who? Oh, you act like you fucking know. Joe Namath.
Oh,
a lot of fucking great quarterbacks come from that Western Pennsylvania.
Must be the water.
That's nothing to do with the fucking water. Why would water make somebody throw more? They grab children, pull them out of the fucking coal mines, and just start having them throw at fucking tires 50 yards away.
Chuck it up!
Yeah, the amount of quarterbacks that come from that area is stunning. Stunning. Jim Kelly's from there.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Is Marino from there by any chance?
Dan Marino was from that area as well.
That's
and
weird.
There's a
the fucking 80s were dominated by these quarterbacks.
There's a great kind of 30 for 30 about the year that all the quarterbacks and that Marino got fucking drafted so late and he was at his house crying and throwing up and shit. Why are you feeling bad?
Yeah,
for
please,
him?
Come on.
Why wouldn't you just start laughing at him?
Yeah.
Because his life turned out great.
Same thing happened to Brady. He was drafted last. Boo hoo. And he's remember that interview where he's crying about how it was the worst day
yeah,
of his life?
Yeah, he fucking cried.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a fucking joke. You're Tom Brady. That was when he had 3 rings. Now he got 4. Chill the fuck out, dude.
I like the little league that you would get drafted, but you didn't know where you went in the draft. So you would just get a call from the coach later.
It's better this way.
I got you.
Hey, where did I draft, coach? Doesn't matter, son. Just glad that you're here. Glad that you're part of Linwood Sunoco. We're going to make the Sunoco chain. I'm excited this year. I'll tell your dad, every home run, free tank of gas.
Holy shit.
Nice. Yeah.
All right, so, well, you can't get past the Kardashian.
He's just staring so deeply.
Oh, God, love Kourtney. She might be my favorite Kardashian now.
Is that right?
Yeah, I think she's moved up.
I'm Chris's favorite. I don't have the biggest butt, but I do have Chris's love. He's so sweet.
She's actually available to you now, too.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That fucking asshole's out of her life.
Well, there it is right there.
Right there. There it is.
You can see it on the iBang today. Now, what do you think is more attractive? That ass or Fez's new love?
Because I'm so happy for Fez's, like, defined love, that's the more attractive thing to me. Carnal pleasure, Kardashian.
It's amazing to me to just see him. He just looks so happy. Fez looks so happy. You know what I mean?
Yeah, Fez is happy. But I see a smile on Kourtney Kardashian's ass, too.
Right.
It's
well, he turned sideways, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like a smirk, really. Yeah.
It's pleased with itself.
Sure it should be.
Hell yeah.
If I saw a mom, I'd be like this. Wow, your daughter's ass. I'd seriously eat it. I'm not even fucking playing games here.
Wouldn't even mind.
No. Love it. Love it.
All about it.
Anywho, how's the rest of the family? How are their asses? All right, so Chris is going to tell us the mystery. Do you want to scope this?
Yeah, I'll scope this.
All right, why don't you scope, because you told me that it's a gigantic, unbelievable story.
All right, so... Remember we had the whiteboard up?
Yeah.
No one came close to what the hell happened.
Oh.
My God.
That's embarrassing because we were really trying hard.
And there were some solid theories that I was like, wow, yeah. that is probably it. But when I called this hospital and got the answer,
yeah,
I was like, I couldn't. Well, let me start the scope.
Yeah, you start the scope. Get yourself
scope it out.
Here. Hand it over and we'll scope you talking so you can use your hands.
Well, I'm connecting. Mystery head wound revealed.
How come it takes you so long to connect? I saw that the other night when you were all drunk and freaked out about it.
I don't know. I'm gonna blame Sprint on this.
Why don't you get a nice fucking iPhone for yourself?
I think it's my service. It's not the actual phone.
No, it's the fucking phone too.
I'm loyal to Android.
Don't put mystery head wound revealed.
Okay.
Was that what you were doing?
Yes.
I knew it.
I'll just do Bennington live in NYC.
Mystery head wound. I knew he was going to go for something like that. Right. I didn't know it was so annoying to start a scope.
Oh, yeah. Takes a lot to scope.
It's initializing the video stream. Here we go.
There's Gail.
Oh, hey, what's up?
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
All right, Chris Stanley. Wait, you're really slow starting here. Wait, you better take that ass picture down. You're going to look like a maniac. It's Christmas.
It's time.
All right, this thing's already fucking up.
How so?
I don't know. How so? That was the gayest thing I've ever heard.
How so?
No wonder your scopes stink.
Oh, I think they're solid. You just gotta be careful. Don't touch the bottom of the phone. It'll.
Why would the bottom of the phone be a problem?
There's buttons on there. There's buttons on it.
But here, yeah, you hold.
Right. Yeah, hold the sides.
You're holding the bottom. You're holding
hold the
bottom
sides,
right now.
Sides, just
I am.
You've got the
sides.
Bottom right now.
I'm holding the sides.
Okay. I noticed that the bottom has been. All right, so let people sign on there. Just start waving, Chris, so everyone realizes it's a
It's really Chris.
It's button down, Chris. You did not get rid of the button downs.
I got used to them. I finally like having a collar. Makes me feel, pretty good.
It looks good on you.
Thank you.
It does.
Thank you. It's a nice checkered pattern today.
I'm not used to seeing you sober, so this is fantastic.
Dead sober, everybody.
All right, I want to just see what some of the people are saying. Old hatchet head.
Yep.
Looking good, baby doll.
Thank
Take
you.
Off the shirt.
I guess.
Is the bus to Bangtan on? He looks less drunk with a shirt and a collar. Less Chris, more Gail.
I'm holding the phone.
Update on Chris mystery. That's what this is about right now. Update on the Stanley mystery. All right, Chris. So go ahead. Here's all we know up to this point. And I'll say this is all Gail and I know.
Yeah.
That you came in after the Christmas party with a hospital thing on your arm.
And a bracelet on, yeah.
A bracelet. Telling us that you woke up in the hospital, but you didn't even remember how you got there. And we remember putting you in an Uber car. And I, that got their shirt scope, bros.
Nice.
Yeah. Scope number one.
I know a lot more shirts went out, right?
Yeah. All the last orders should be out by Friday, or they should be received by Friday.
Oh, that's exciting.
Oh, that's from a scope.
Well, we should get more scope bro pictures up. I love those.
Love my scope
Please
bros.
Send us right. your scope
so
bro pics.
Tell us what you found out.
Okay. So, last we heard, I blacked out, woke up in the hospital. I called the hospital last night, and I asked to say, hey, I explained to them, hello, I was put into the hospital last night. I don't remember how I got there. I don't remember what happened. Could someone please tell me? Could you connect me to the ER? They connect me to the ER. First of all, the first woman is just chuckling as I'm telling her this story.
Oh, no.
Like you're already a legend or just hearing about it?
Just hearing about me fucking saying, like, I went to the hospital, don't know how I got there. I get connected to the ER. I go, hey, my name is Chris Stanley. I was admitted last night. Could you please give me the details? Was there a report? Was there discharge papers? What happened? They're like, please hold. They're annoyed
already. Please hold.
I'm on hold for about 10 minutes. Doctor comes on. Tells me my blood alcohol level.
All right, let's all try to guess. Okay. Now, what is legally drunk?
0.08.
Okay, I'm gonna say you're a 1.4.
I'm gonna say you blew a 2.
Wow, that would be ridiculous.
4 times the legal limit, 0.32 was my blood alcohol level.
Whoa.
Wow.
While in the hospital, I was given a CAT scan, which I have no recollection of. I was then given an IV. They did give me fluids. So they tell me all this, and I'm like, okay, thanks.
How come you didn't have a hole in your arm? You even showed us.
Yeah, there's nothing.
You don't have a hole in your arm.
They told me
You're
was
fucking Wolverine.
Wait, it makes sense, though, because how would he have been able to even speak yesterday? Considering how bad off he was, he would have been really in trouble. So it makes sense that you got fluids.
And you were pissing a lot yesterday.
Yeah.
It was constant piss coming out of me.
And so pooping, but that was unrelated.
3-2.
Yeah.
0.32.
No, the pooping had more to do with the garlic.
Awful. All right, so that's the doctor talk. All right, the doctor tells me those details. And then I was like, all right, so do I have a concussion, whatever? Like, no, the CAT scan came back okay. I was like, okay, but could you tell me how I got there? Like, what happened? Did I come into my own? Did an Uber driver bring me in? Like, who came with me? So he puts me back on hold. I'm on hold another 5 minutes. And a woman comes on, I guess a nurse who was reading through the fucking, and it has a report from the EMTs. The report said that I was found in front of my apartment building, passed out drunk. The EMTs arrived. They woke me up. I ran away from them.
Oh my God.
Wait, let's just stop there.
Hold on.
Because that is so Stanley.
He always runs from trouble.
You ran away?
I'm going to guess. In my head, I thought, I don't need to go to a fucking ambulance. I don't need to go to a hospital. I'm just drunk.
Dude, let's just remember this. Chris Stanley running is already famous on Periscope.
I'm running from the EMTs at some point. Fall and crack my fucking head open. They put me in the ambulance and I begin vomiting.
Oh, sure.
Oh, boy.
And then they bring me to the hospital, Mount Sinai, Western Queens, where I am given a unconscious CAT scan to make sure my brain isn't fucking rattled and pumped full of fluids and left to sleep it off. But if that whatever person that passed by me didn't fucking wake me up, didn't fucking call the ambulance, I wouldn't have this head wound.
No. But do you think you would have slept it off comfortably there on the street?
Probably. Not comfortably, but I would have.
This is the fucking problem with Uber. They got to take you out of the car and get you tucked into bed.
Okay, here's what I'm going to say.
Yeah.
I don't doubt that most of this is true.
Okay.
But you have a fucking head wound on the back of your head.
Right. Yeah. How did you fall?
How did you fall?
They didn't explain that.
They tackled you down.
Oh, no.
And they cracked your head. And they're like, this idiot fell. They walked into the hospital. Like, I don't know what happened to this dumbass.
Oh, shit. You're right.
They fucking tackled you. They tackled you to the ground. And you have no resistance in your body. And they're totally lying. What did you, like, hit a stop sign and fall backwards? There's no way you fell backwards on your head from running away.
And my back.
Once you get going, no one's going to catch you. So
I got speed. I got acceleration.
You got sacked is what happened. Your ass got sacked.
So that's...
Now, you were laughing at the person yesterday, the young lady, who blew a 2-something.
Yeah.
And you went 3-2.
Yeah. 3-2. A third of my blood was alcohol. I think that's what that means. Not 100% sure.
I hope that's not true.
It's true. The fucking doctor came on.
A third of your blood is in alcohol.
That's what all that vodka.
Oh, hey, what's up, Tom Sharpling? Tom Sharpling's here.
What do you write?
Hey, Sharpling.
He said, "What's up?
What's up? You're up, dude. Happy Christmas to you.
Happy Christmas, Sharpie.
Get Chris a date with lobster claws. Gail's a cutie.
Hey,
this
thanks.
Is insanity. A third of 1%, you idiot.
Oh, that's not that good at all.
But still, pure alcohol in the blood when this should be none.
People are wondering if we can get a .32 shirt going.
That's what he says.
Your scope, bro. You get up to 3-2.
What a rocker says it was 32% of your blood.
All right, so this guy said 0.5 could be fatal. So he had plenty of fucking room, dude.
Come on, that's wiggle room around. Right there.
One would be 100%.
So three times his blood was alcohol.
He had more alcohol than blood.
How bad are you when you read those fucking commercials when you get to the drink responsibly? Here's where we fucked up. And Joe, Gail, Vito, everyone will know this. The next time that there's an office party, it will not be open bar. Because if Chris was paying for that, he probably would have had a couple cocktails.
Yeah.
Oh,
no. And we would have focused on the food.
Yeah. If.
Nowhere near. Oh, cash bar?
He would have had like 3 PBRs.
This guy said, why was the Uber $52? That is a good fucking point.
Because the guy took a shitty way to the, and it was I think it was a surge going on.
Who's calling you, Gail?
That's not my phone.
Oh yeah, it's Chris's phone. Oh, yeah,
probably a creditor.
Sure, I'll take it then. Yeah, he's got plenty of money.
No, don't say
he's got all the monies and the coins and the people. Pretty great.
Well, I hope Chris turns into an egg cream drunk.
And as the nurse was telling me, she was laughing her ass off, just full on laughing as she was reading.
That's
this
fucking New
report.
York for you.
Oh my God.
She was out. I gave her a big fucking laugh.
I know for a fact there's not a surge on a fucking
Tuesday night or whatever we went.
Oh, that's a good fucking point, yeah.
You get a surge like when it's Thanksgiving or Christmas.
But maybe I was raining. Thinking that maybe it was because of all the Christmas parties. There were a lot of people out for
Dude,
a weekday.
There were a lot of fucking cabs out, too.
Yeah.
You caught a cab on the street. Fucking this asshole over here catches a cab on the street. Then he told everybody it was a train. Why, Joe? Why did you lie?
I don't know.
What's the truth?
It was I confused the T on the taxi for the J train. I thought it said J.
I couldn't believe Chris. That was the fucking reason I
Chris, you got sacked for sure. They tackled the shit out of you.
Well, I was fucking lovely asleep, fucking feeling pretty good, I'm guessing. And then they fucking wake me up and bust
Wait,
my balls.
This is good. Josh just said maybe the EMT picked up a rock. These are the days of our Bennington lives. Someone writes rehab. Oh, Carla, of course, always trying to get him into rehab. You are not going to rehab.
No.
But you said you would attend a meeting with me during your, what did you call it, a timeout or a dry out?
I believe it was a cleanse. I've used the word cleanse and dry out. Yeah. Just pump the brakes a little bit.
By the way, a cleanse has to do with your eating as well.
Yes. Oh, really?
So you're giving up greasy food.
And you will be pooping a lot. That's
I poop a lot
what
anyway.
I hear.
You guys are starting to be dumb girls. You know, it's coming up every... Some fucking Hicks is turning into a brown boy. Now, I thought we would turning do this. Too. And Joe, come on over. Because we were all... I want you to be... Come on over, Joe, because you're going to be the girl who hands this off. We all got you a Christmas / welcome not into the hospital gift.
Oh, thank you.
And it's our way of saying... we love you.
Oh, I love you guys.
We enable you.
Oh, yes.
You know what I mean? We put up with this instead of crying. But we thought about this, and all of us, first of all, we had fun because we went out to buy this together, the
yes.
three of us.
Shit. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, it took us three different shopping excursions.
What?
But we thought we'd let the littlest hand it over to you. This Aww. Is, we believe, pure you.
Oh, this is so sweet.
And we hope that you love it.
Thank you, young
And just
Joseph.
Think of it, have it with your morning coffee.
Oh.
Is all we ask.
Okay. Oh, I love this. I love yeah. presents. Oh, shit.
Yeah.
This is fucking great.
Open it up so people can't just see when you yell, fucking great. And you're on the radio.
It's a beautiful Army Man mug. Do it. Give me a fucking drink.
Now you got to turn around so people can see the Army Man. And the mug. There it is.
Love it. This is great. Oh, I swear to God, if anyone gives me a fucking drink and a paper cup from now on.
What? Oh. What? Oh, that's it. Pour good. Ice all over the.
Good.
Oh, yeah. It's okay.
It is good.
It'll take a while for it to melt yeah. into the board.
Plus, we're off for 2 weeks.
Oh, it tastes better in the Army Man cup.
You got to turn so people can see the Army Man, you mutt.
He's drinking! So refreshing! I'm hydrated! This is great! Oh, this is so awesome. Thank you guys so much. This is the shit.
Aww.
I hope that you love it, Chris.
I do love it. It's fucking great.
I love that it's legitimately called Army Man Mug.
yeah, there he is with his Army Man. Rob in Kansas.
Yeah, hey, Ronnie. 0.32 is reaching alcohol poisoning levels, and part of the way people die from alcohol poisoning is you lose your gag reflex at that point.
Well, he didn't die, Rob.
Guess what? I ain't gonna
fucking die.
I beat the fucking odds.
He can't die. He can't even kill himself. No one ever quotes Bugsy. Turn it around so we can get the full. Yeah, nice close up of Army Man.
This is the shit.
You. Your Army Man.
Move this it over a little bit to the other side. There, get it centered.
This is a beautiful mug.
That's dark and back in that hole that you're in.
Oh, yeah, it's. I live in a dark hole.
It's pretty badass, huh?
It's...
Everyone's
like, drink it!
Drink! Yeah! I think I will! Do it! Drink! Ah! It's so good!
No, I don't want to make a big thing about that, but it was a lot of money, so don't break it.
Oh, God, no. I'm going to treat this like a baby.
We actually had a guy make it and then make the box for it.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
How? How does anyone go about making a box?
Believe me, it's beautiful.
I mean, I get the ceramics, but Jesus, that's amazing.
All right, I think we're going to shut this down now. And we got to start the show.
Okay.
You know, let's go from a piece of shit who had a terrible year, like Chris Stanley, to a man who had a documentary made about his life. Can you imagine?
I cannot.
That's what I want to have happen to me. That a well-known, well-respected film director follows me around. I do nothing but tell my regular stories. And then people go into theaters and watch that. That's what Barry Crimmins says. Had. Barry.
Ron, how are you?
What a year you had, buddy.
Oh, man. Thanks to you guys. And that's why I'm calling, not just on my own, but on behalf of the Campaign for Holiday Trousers.
Oh, good. Still going on.
Yeah, well, you're the tri-state chairman.
Thank you.
Can't thank you enough for your tireless work on our behalf. But, you know, at the holidays, I want to remind people to be grateful for the little things, like that head wound that Chris got.
Sure.
Because that drained probably enough of the poison out of him to save his life.
Right.
And, you know, and when he goes on the cleanse, the EPA will have to supervise it because it'll be a Superfund site. But I want to thank Chris in particular for seeing me through one of the most horrid experiences of my life, and that was when I became a scope bro with him on Periscope. He's a big-hearted, wonderful galoot of a hammered guy, and I love you, Chris.
I love you, Barry Crimmins.
All the best at the holidays, pal, and Gail came on like gangbusters on the new show, and just tremendous, darling Gail, and she shows up when I come and play town, and such a dear, so wonderful, so funny, good bloodlines there.
I adore you, Barry. I'm so, so blessed to have you as a friend now.
Well, yes, and there's no shaking me. and hello, Joey Jojo, and, you know, your gracious and humble assistance at the show is always appreciated. I know Dan's gone, Dan Perlman's gone, but not forgotten. He's come out of that Bennington incubator, and he will go on to great things like so many others have under your tutelage, Ron.
It is true.
A man whose heart's so big they have to bring it up in the freight elevator every day
it
to
is
the
true.
Studio. So thank you for how much you helped us plug Call Me Lucky. Thank you for you know, taking the doors off the studio whenever I'm in the building and allowing me to wander in. And, you know, thank you for everything. I've done a lot of interviews this year. I've done a lot of radio. And bar none, the Unmasked with you was the most fun. And when I finally heard it, I realized how shot I was that day.
Yeah.
And you were just a total sweetheart and, you know, a brilliant interviewer as ever. And it's so much fun to do your show.
We're gonna play that again next week, right, Chris?
Yes, that's playing next week.
Do we know which day?
Actually, it's playing the week after. It's playing December 29th.
December 29th.
Perfect. The day I'm at Johnny D's in Somerville, Mass.
Fantastic.
Perfect.
For my holiday show in Boston, the day after my holiday show in Portland, Maine at Blue. So that works out perfectly.
Well, Barry, best of luck to you, and have a great 2016, my friend.
Thank you very much. Rochester on January 2nd, too, at the Comedy Club. I don't know how they came up with the name, but
it's brilliant. It's literally brilliant.
Got to be innovative in this business.
Yeah.
So, anyway, I love you guys, and I really just want to say thank you so much for all you did to help promote the film and me. And it's great, and I'm having a great time out doing this tour that will last until hopefully we shoot a special sometime in the early spring. So, I love you guys. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, applicable season's greetings to all.
All right, talk to you later, my friend.
Love
Peace.
You.
Take care, Barry.
Bye, Barry.
So what is the day, that date again that we'll be playing that?
December 29th.
That's Smitty's birthday.
There you go.
Hardest punching man I've ever seen in my life, Mr. Terry Smith. Hit like a fucking mule. Like a mule. When we were children. He could knock out adults. And I'm not. I know a lot of people like to act like, oh, there was a tough guy in my neighborhood. He could knock out an adult.
Jesus.
Yeah.
And did.
Yes. Of course he did. But heart of gold. Best friend or worst enemy? Which one do you want to be? I picked best friend. I thought it was a smart move.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But
with that punch,
you've got to. With that punch in my wise mouth, we're going to fucking go places. Because I'll show you guys to lose their temper. You know, I'll give you a chance to be a hero. If that's what you're looking for. You want to be a white knight? Hang around with this damsel. So that's going to be great. We're playing that. Now, tomorrow is the Bill Burr Unmasked. And that has to do with his new animated series, F is for Family. Very funny. It's like Bill Burr, but it's cartoony.
Okay. I like cartoons. I like Bill Burr.
Well, imagine if you saw Bill Burr as a cartoon dad.
I'd love it.
That's what he is. A kind of a nice cartoon dad. Based slightly on his own dad. But not enough that his dad could sue.
Oh, good.
I'm so excited we're finally getting to share this Unmasked. It's awesome.
I know. It's been around a while, hasn't it?
Yeah.
That came from the great Michael O'Brien. I don't know what his actual job title is, but if there's anyone in comedy, Michael handles their affairs with publicity and stuff like that. I mean, the biggest names. Now, you think with all that, he'd be arrogant, but he's the sweetest guy I ever met.
He's the man. He's really awesome.
Although I was with him once when he mistakenly ate a peanut, and he has a peanut allergy.
Oh, shit.
Oh, that's scary.
Yeah, and I can't remember who it was. We were doing it down at the old comics. We were doing an Unmasked.
Is it Gaffigan?
I don't think it was Gaffigan. Might have been Lewis Black, but I'm not sure.
What happened? Did he go red or his face got all puffy?
There used to be a girl who kind of ran the backstage. This is when we were just XM. So a girl's job was to just take care of everybody backstage until we came out and did the show. And it was great. You could get food. I saw a guy get a haircut. Whatever you want.
Nice.
We'll take care of. Wine, champagne, whatever you want. So they bring in this. It's like Thai wraps, right? And they're eating it. And he's like, I hope there's not peanuts in here. She's like, yeah, hi, there's peanuts. He's like, I'm allergic to peanuts. And we're watching the allergy take effect.
Oh, God.
And he's like, I'll wait till after the show. And we were like, me and whoever the act was just screaming at him, no!
Get help!
Your throat is closing! Because I'm fucking always nervous about, any kind of choking thing. And, I think he went and had a shot or whatever, but he was okay.
Yeah.
But a great man.
Oh, that is scary.
Yeah, it was. It was a scary thing. And then, the whole time that we were doing the Unmasked, I'm like, I'm saying to myself, I hope Michael's not dead. Much like when we put Chris in an Uber.
And I survived.
Here's what makes me annoyed by your story.
Yeah.
I walk home at night all the time. There's people passed out on the street. I don't fucking bother them or call 911. I'm thinking, you fucking asshole, you can't even make it to your house?
Yeah. I mean, I don't mind that. Yeah, that's all whoever called this fucking ambulance that's the only thing I have to say. That guy's an asshole.
I hope it's someone that you know. I hope it's like a neighbor who looked over.
I think it might be a neighbor.
Oh, it has to be, right?
Yeah, or my super. Oh, my God. I haven't seen like anyone in my building, really. I haven't ran into anyone.
I hope that you tried to run and fell in front of them, too.
I had to have, because if they called the ambulance, if they cared enough to call an ambulance, they'd wait around for the ambulance.
Just to watch the show.
Oh, sure.
Well, no matter what, it's really going to help your reputation in the building.
Oh, yeah, that guy who passes out drunk and smokes. Guess what? Good luck getting me out. Maybe if I run into him, I'll just tell him I was roofied.
Now, I know your doctor, the pit doc.
Yeah.
And he wrote about, your problems. And then he also says in this, maybe I got to make a switch with my Christmas present for Chris.
No, what? There's no switches that need to be made. Come on, Pit Doc. I'm a responsible young man.
There will be no more open bars.
Oh, fuck.
We can't risk it, dude. There's no reason that all the rest of us should feel bad like enablers.
Do not feel bad. I made my own decisions.
No. I don't worry about what happened to you this time. I mean, you go into a coma or you're dead or whatever. Then I will sit around. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was the Christmas party we had that Chris died.
Yeah, exactly.
But I didn't. And I'm not.
We should have learned our lesson after the previous Christmas party. He cracked the back of his head open.
And really, the only reason I...
You're really into this thing now, too. It's our fault, really.
Mm-mm. It's my neighbor's fault for fucking. I would have fucking been on the floor, puke up a little bit of that bad stuff, and then I go home. I will go upstairs.
Bad stuff. What are you, five?
Yes.
Bad stuff came out.
I think Barry brought up that he was in Rochester. Isn't that video of the guy who's doing the news report and the bank robber runs by him in Rochester?
Yeah, it is.
Now, here's what I don't understand about Rochester. All right, well, first of all, watch the video and then I'll bring it up. So here's a guy reporting on the street. And, all right, they're throwing it to him now, these lovely news people. But just watch how this rolls down.
Adam Salad thought it would be just a routine live shot during our midday newscast. He was standing here in front of the Sterling State Bank to deliver a live update to the bank robbery story we first brought you yesterday. Little did Adam know that during that live shot, the same suspect police had been looking for was inside that very bank committing another robbery. What happened next played out live on air.
Go this bank in North.
That guy right there.
What?
That's the robber.
Oh, that's the robber. This is live TV, folks. That's the robber just went by.
That's an employee of the bank alerting Adam that the man who just robbed them again was fleeing the scene.
I'll talk to you later. Yeah, once I left that screen, my first instinct was to see if I could see the suspect anywhere else and also call 911 as fast as possible.
Police arrived on scene and took statements.
Second. You notice that the camera doesn't swing, right?
What the fuck? That drove me nuts. That was the first thing I thought. He's in live TV mode, and he's trying to... Hey, cameraman, live TV, exactly. Turn your fucking camera, dude.
I'm going to tell you what had to have happened. There is no cameraman. This poor fucking guy sets this thing up on a tripod.
Oh, my God. I've seen those.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
That's probably right, because I was thinking, what kind of cameraman doesn't turn his camera when they say, there's the robber?
They've gotten so cheap with money these days because of the fucking internet that they can't hire as many people for these things. So
he's just tripod, man.
He's got a tripod himself. And then they would have had the shot of the century, a guy running down the street with a fucking bag of money wearing a tiny little fucking mask over his eyes.
The bag just printed with a large dollar sign.
Those are the best.
That's how you know there's money in it.
All my bags are emblazoned with what's inside them on the outside.
All right, I don't know what this means. Somebody sent it to me. This is from Jay Moore. Okay, at Grammys. Time for you to hear at Bennington Show. Ronnie, let's show them. Whenever, wherever, hashtag best ever. You're a fucking sweet man, Jay Moore.
He is a sweet man.
I don't even know
man.
What that means. They don't give out Grammys for fucking radio shows, but that's nice. You know what? Everybody's feeling Christmassy.
Yeah, it's a great feeling. I mean, I got through this fucking thing unscathed. I'm feeling awesome.
It's the season of giving.
Kind of at least on life, I feel like.
Howard, you're on the Bennington show. Yeah.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about what happens to Chris at a Christmas party because his family's not going to sue you.
Well, first of all, my worry wasn't being sued. My worry was our friend died.
Yeah, that was concern number one.
Yeah.
In fact, suing just now came up for the first time.
That wasn't even low
on the list. It didn't make the list.
I wonder how much of that had to do with how much food that you ate, too.
Oh, God.
Yes. I mean, I think that could have played into your sleep.
I feel like I ate most of the steak that was handed out.
Now, I know that you would find this hard to believe because you're an everyday drinker. Joey can't go anyplace without having a drink. Same with Gail. Even though you're not on a Chris level, you guys actually have some kind of social anxieties that feels like you must drink. That night, and I've trained myself to do this, as many people have, you go there to celebrate. You basically feel buzzed from all the excitement and fun and dancing. And the next day, I literally felt hungover between the food and getting out of my, you know, week time schedule.
Well, there was a moment where when we were all dancing around, the whole restaurant was on our feet, and we were like doing the Jewish dance around the whole room, and I was like laughing so hard, looking over at everybody at different corners of the room, like holding hands with strangers and dancing, and I was like, I feel fucking high right now. Like, I was laughing so hard.
Well, here's the thing, too, about Sammy's Romanian. It is such a weird throwback, right? And my table faced the room, so I could see all the other people celebrating. And it looked like if Mickey Mantle would have walked in, you would have not been surprised. But I literally felt like this seems like someone else's memory. You know what I mean? Like, this is so far out of the food that we eat, the way that we party, the music that we would listen to.
And the
to.
Way that place looked. Like, right. It's like, you know, it hasn't changed.
Yes, and the way that the place looked also. But you can put yourself in the state of, I'm going to be weird for a couple hours. You don't have to be drunk to celebrate.
And our table was so great, too. At first, I was wondering if we were going to be too close, if we were going to be able to do our own thing and be in our own conversation. It ended up being the best table in the room because we were right on top of Donnie Love the entire night. And it was hilarious.
He's throwing napkins. He's screaming. Yeah. He would stop and come over and hug you and kiss your head every fucking 15, 20 minutes. Now, here's the other thing about our table. Half our table didn't drink.
Oh, yeah.
So that probably left you more room to feel like you needed to bring it on and scream at the drinkers, come on, you pussies, and kind of ruin their night.
I just wanted to, you know, make sure they were having a good time. I was trying to be a good host.
Why? But. First of all, you're not the host. Unless you want the fucking bill, you are not the fucking host. So, did you get around to apologizing to Joe? Because you kind of ruined his night a little bit.
I never apologized to Joe.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
It's not too late.
We got a break here. We were supposed to even break before this because we had so many live reads to do today. We'll be right. Oh, coming up a little later on, you're going to be excited about this. What two comics do we have dropping in?
Mr. Jim Florentine and Don Jameson.
And they've got a brand new album out.
Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6. That's available now on iTunes.
We'll be right back. It's The Bennington Show. Coming up a little bit, two of our buddies.
Don Jameson and Mr. Jim Florentine.
And you say Noah Trunk?
Noah Trunk.
Odd. I find that to be somewhat peculiar. Because those three are thicker than thieves. Well, that Eddie Trunk wasn't about to be let out of this. You've got something you want to talk to us about, Gail.
Yeah, so Google has put out their top searches.
All right, now Google.
For 2015.
Is that like Ask Jeeves, but for founders?
Exactly. Okay. It's what the founders use instead of Jeeves.
Okay.
And they don't even talk to Jeeves at all.
Now, how is this broken down?
So there's just the general top searches. Mm-hmm. Then they also have a bunch of subcategories so you can find out things like who are the most searched actresses or athletes or what's the biggest searches for cars or diets. So they have a bunch of different
Let's go through this. First of all, I'm going to say most searched in the thing has got to be ass play. Ass play has to be up there.
Rimming?
You would think so. But I think that they have taken all pornographic searches out of the equation.
All right, let's take us to athletics.
Okay.
I'm going to say Deflategate has to be up there pretty high.
So they have done it by athlete. So not just athletic stories. So this is by athlete. So who can you guess from the top 10? Top athlete searches.
I'm going to guess LeBron James has got to be pretty high.
LeBron James is not on here.
What? All right. Serena Williams.
That's good.
Serena Williams is not on here.
Come on.
Stephon Curry.
Oh.
Stephon Curry. Yes. Number three.
Oh, there's two people higher than him.
Tom Brady?
Yeah.
Tom Brady is not on here.
Oh, no.
What athlete? Peyton Manning?
Peyton? No.
Eli?
No.
Lamar Odom?
No. Do you want a hint for one and two?
Yeah. Oh, wait. I think I know one. All right. Got it?
Yeah.
Ronda Rousey.
Ronda Rousey's number one.
Whoa.
Most searched athlete.
You know why? Sport and ass play.
Yeah.
Nice. Both.
And then the disappointing loss, and she disappointed everyone, even though they told us she could beat up any man.
Yeah.
She can't even beat up any woman.
She's a fucking Terminator.
I second.
Number two.
Yeah.
Also female.
Not Serena. Who's a famous female athlete besides Serena?
I was going to say Bruce Jenner slash Caitlyn, but I guess it's, is that
Bruce athlete, Jenner athlete? Slash cock Caitlyn?
Cock Caitlyn.
No. Number two is Ronda Rousey's opponent, Holly Holm.
Oh.
But the crazy thing, there's another female on the list.
Yeah, it's not crazy. Guys want to look at chicks.
Hope Solo. Hope Solo is also on the list. Number six.
Oh, yeah. She had a bunch of problems this year.
All right, let's guess.
What do you mean, bunch of problems? She was fucking destroyed. This was her redemption year. She had her problems the year before this.
Oh, okay, that's the booze. All right.
So let's do top.
Look, you're the booze hound, dude. Yeah.
Top searches overall for 2015 of any category.
I'm gonna go. Chris mentioned it, so this is cheating. But Caitlyn Jenner has to be top three.
Caitlyn Jenner is number four.
Has to be top four.
That's what you meant to say.
I got one.
Are these, by the way, these are individuals, people?
Individuals, movies, place. Mm.
Star Wars.
Star Wars is not.
The fart awakens, Star Wars.
No, you would think.
About this, ISIS or ISIL.
No, not search for, but is this censored search?
I wouldn't even search. What do you got, Joe?
Donald T. Rump.
Donald Trump is not on this list.
Bullshit.
Google's full of fucking shit.
Do you think they're lying about these searches?
I know they're lying.
That's why I'm a DuckDuckGo.com guy myself.
I don't even know what that is.
Another search engine.
DuckDuck what?
DuckDuckGo.com.
Never heard of this.
Yes, another search engine out there.
Search something, Chris. See what happens.
I'm search fucking...
It's going to send you to Google.
Bill Cosby. How about that?
No, you know what? Search yourself.
Okay, Chris Stanley.
Okay.
I'm a Canadian professional ice hockey player who's currently playing with the Fishtown Penguins in the German second Bundesliga.
Nice. True.
I was selected by the Vancouver Canucks in the fourth round of the 97 NHL draft.
I will never use Duck Duck Goose again.
I'm also an actor.
You're everyone but yourself.
Oh my god, that guy's name is Chris Stanley?
Yeah, he's on
fucking such.
Are
a
you
hunk.
Kidding me?
Yeah, he's on Mad Men.
Yeah.
That means you're like the ugliest Chris Stanley out there.
Old Bertie Draper's second husband.
You're the goose to their ducks.
Jesus
Chris
Christ.
Stanley.
Oh, and there's a folk singer named Chris Stanley too.
I got a feeling that Joe's friend fucking started Duck Duck. Goose.
Yeah, this is some bullshit startup out of fucking Bushwick.
See the tech savvy one?
Yeah.
Sharpest attack.
They're all pretty tech savvy.
It seems like they're all tech savvy and good with the ladies. It doesn't really make sense, but.
Yeah, it's never happened before. He and his fucking friends look like that stupid nerd show on TV right now. Big Bang.
You look like
the Big Bang fucking nerds.
Oh, you're so Big Bang.
Hey, they're good with the ladies, too.
Well, on DuckDuckGo, if you search Chris Stanley, the actor comes up, and then me. In the middle of all this.
Man, that's a terrible pick of you.
Oh, God, yeah. Let's get that.
God, that's disgusting.
I don't know why I was growing that fucking beard.
Why? I understand.
You're growing it now. The
need to grow a beard.
Ew, who would grow a beard?
It looks exactly the same. There's nothing different in that beard.
Why were you trimming it, at least?
It was wild, that beard.
He never trims.
Oh, man. It's like
when he gets too wild now, he just shaves and restarts.
Yeah.
But he never trims his beard.
Oh, no, never. Never that. Fuck that. And it gets like steel wool. Like, it's gruff. It's a gruff beard. It's wiry.
I get the same way.
Pirate beard.
Fucking thing's a pushy shredder you got on your face.
Fucked up.
All right, is any rest of this worth fucking getting into?
The number one search is an athlete who was in the news.
Oh, who killed somebody or something?
No.
Was it War Machine, that fucking UFC guy who beat up that porn star?
Had a health issue. Had a health issue and was in the news.
Oh, Odom.
Lamar Odom is number one search.
Well, yeah, because that works for the Kardashian fans, though.
Exactly. It works for everybody.
And if he was number one overall, why wasn't he in the athlete list?
I don't know.
He's not an athlete anymore. He's not a current athlete.
Yeah,
he's
I guess that's why he was off that list.
Come on, Chris.
Two and three are both movies.
Two and three?
Yes. And they're not Star Wars.
Trumbo.
First of all, the people who are in it don't even fucking search Trumbo. I've been on the search. I can't even find it in a fucking movie theater in New York.
It'll be on demand soon enough.
I like it. I like a movie that's released like that.
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't go to see this in a movie theater, but I don't mind watching it here.
Just click a button. It's on. Great.
Oh, enjoy it.
I don't know what. Oh, summer Galaxy blockbuster. Galaxy Quest.
No, that was the previous summer. This was the big summer blockbuster of this summer.
Oh.
Did Avengers 2 come out this year?
No. Did it? Yeah, Avengers 2.
But it's not that.
I know the answer. What? And Chris Pratt was in this summer blockbuster as well. Jurassic World.
That's correct. Number two search.
Dude, Jurassic World came out in like 1992.
Oh, wait. What the fuck Jurassic are you Park thinking? 5.
Yeah.
And why is everyone Googling it then, huh? Why is everybody Googling it?
Because we didn't have Google then. So now we do. Now we,
now
go back.
We can finally Google the things we didn't get to Google.
Stuff we were curious about in the early 90s. All right, another movie?
Yeah, the other movie was an Oscar-nominated movie.
Concussion.
Last year.
Yeah.
Nominated last year.
Lincoln.
Dances with Wolves.
Yeah. Yes! Because we never got to Google Dances.
We never got to Google it. But apparently there were real Indians in that movie.
Wow. I just Googled Two Socks pictures.
Yeah.
Because I just thought he was so cute.
When I was out west, was on a reservation, and I met some Indians, and I actually said to them, I go, now, are you from India or Native Americans? This is at a fucking place where I buy blankets. And then I ended up getting really sick from using those blankets.
You a little bit cold? You want to maybe wrap up if you're so
put
cold?
A blanket. Wrap yourself in the blanket.
It's a little chilly, isn't it?
I don't think you're getting too sick. Put on a little small backpack in.
So soft. So soft.
You're going to love it. They're actually doing it.
No, please, it's free.
Share it with your brother.
It's my pleasure.
No cure for it. So comfortable, there's no cure for it. You know, that is true. Tragedy plus time.
I know.
Tragedy plus time. I always did tragedy minus time.
Hey, like, you went back in time.
Yeah, I started doing 9/11 jokes on 9/10.
Whoa.
Yeah. And I go, please, it's over your head. You'll get it tomorrow. We'll see where I'm coming from.
Was anyone laughing?
No.
They were so confused.
No one laughed. I bombed. all right, so that's all of them?
Yeah, that's every single one. It was American Sniper was the number three search. American Sniper.
Too. Yeah, the baby was fake. It was the world's worst fake baby. You never saw that?
Uh-uh.
You're fucking kidding me.
I didn't see it.
All right.
I didn't see the sniper. Right,
here's what happens. So he comes home from stationed overseas, I think it was called Sniper Land or something.
Yeah,
where,
sure.
Yeah, so he comes back to Texas because I think he was part of ZZ Top. Now, he has a wife and a baby, and this is the scene with the baby. Keep an eye on the baby. Look at it.
It's a fucking doll.
He just lifted a doll.
Oh, my God.
I guess.
Come on. That looks ridiculous.
Yeah.
That looks so dumb. What? That looks so terrible.
What was Clint thinking?
What the fuck is this dude thinking? He's an Oscar-nominated actor. Why wouldn't you say, Clint, I'm not doing this fucking scene?
Dude, the world is filled with babies. You couldn't get a baby?
Not only that, but do you really even need a baby in this scene?
No. Just have the baby...
It's in the crib.
In the crib. He's looking at a fake baby when he looks like that. That face you just made, was that a fucking doll?
Now, this guy's supposed to be a sniper. Perfect eyesight. And so don't do a baby.
Why is he being so careful with that baby doll?
Oh, it's made out of porcelain. That might be the worst scene in history.
Maybe that's why everybody was searching it on Google. They were trying to look for that fake baby scene.
Why was he stationed in Sniperland?
I don't know.
He was a sniper. Where else is he going to go?
Plus, I didn't even recognize Jennifer Lawrence in that. She looks so different.
Really different.
She just had a wig on.
Let's go to Dan in Florida. Dan, what's up?
Hey, buddies. Hey, I just saw that movie the other night on the TV, and yeah, the baby was definitely really fake. But if you go a little bit before that, when his wife's in the waiting room, it's the most disgusting looking fakest pregnant stomach I've ever seen in my life, dude. It looks like a freaking. It looks like maybe the stomach from Alien. I don't know, but look at the fake baby stomach before the baby was born in that movie.
So
it was
Clint
horrible,
Eastwood is
man.
Just like so old now, and he doesn't give a shit about the women part of this. That he doesn't care how that comes out.
Just stuff a pillow in there.
Because the sniper scenes look fucking amazing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, you think it would be really difficult to do a sniper scene. And then, you know, he can't pull off these.
They're just in a room with a baby.
Just someone comes up to him. We just need your approval on this.
Yeah,
fake
whatever.
Yeah, just take a look.
Yeah, you got it.
All right.
I'm setting up a sniper shot right now. Go ahead, make my day. All right, in this scene, you take the plastic baby and act like it's real. Twirl it around like you would a real baby. Lay it down without breaking its fucking neck. And action, cut, perfect. I don't know how I keep doing this fucking movie after movie.
There's no second takes.
Oh, one more thing, Obama. Yeah, I'm going to tell you something, sir.
Are you talking to an empty chair?
Yes. An invisible Obama's in that chair.
I don't get it. Does anyone get this?
Shoot it. Shoot me yelling at Obama. And I'm going to push him over. That would have been the greatest thing was when Eastwood did that. By the way, I am such a fan of his. That the minute that I saw the clip of that, I just fucking turned it off because I don't want to think of him that way. But I thought it would have been perfect. He just pulls his dick out and just starts pissing on an empty chair. Oh, there's George Takei, as in okay. The Star Trek.
Yeah, yeah. George Takei.
Here, Obama, drink my piss. I know you fucking love it. Yeah, that's it.
Just starts humping the air.
Suck my piss. You just see all these Republican delegates, their eyes. Like one dude. Yeah! Piss on that fucker!
Get that urine out!
Piss on that Keegan!
Drain it, Clint!
Yeah. You like this dick?
I love it, Clint! Woo! Hell yeah!
Wait, look out, sniper.
Oh!
Oh, that's just an army man mug that he has.
Love it! What a dream, son, Clint!
Now I'm going to turn my ass around so you can lick my asshole, Mr. President.
I'll rim you too, baby. Come on.
Wait. That was supposed to be an insult thing. Not a...
never mind.
That was a sexual fun thing.
Oh, go, Clint. No, I like the fake baby.
Army man called him baby.
That was uncomfortable.
I'll bring that too, baby.
I love you, baby. All right, someone wrote in, DuckDuckGo doesn't keep a search history.
Mm.
Well, perfect, then.
It's great.
Mm, I like the sound of that.
Yeah. Ask play. Oh, look, I did my name, and it's actually me. Not a bunch of fucking people from other stuff.
Pissed as that hockey player and that actor and that folk singer above me. The folk singer owns ChrisStanley.com. Never going to get that URL for myself.
Oh, no.
Do-do-do-do-do-do.
I'm all about this DuckDuckGo now.
I don't know. I don't like it that much. I like to know what I've been searching for. It's great to have a nice record of everything.
But I still like to know what I've been searching for.
We need to break again.
Well, we need to give out a prize for Tito's Holiday Spirit. We're doing one of these today and one of these tomorrow. And this Tito's has called this episode. They want to sponsor the year in comedy starting next week.
Oh, that's right. Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
By the way, when we're on vacation, it's going to be better than when we're here.
Yeah.
A lot better.
Yes, for everyone.
Yeah.
For you, for us, for the whole of
Chris won't be part of it.
Oh.
God damn it! I can't wait for this! Keep coming out! Keep that bomb out! 0.32! 0.32!
0.32!
All right, what are we giving away for the Tito's Holiday?
Paul Anka's Christmas album, Songs of December, signed by Mr. Paul Anka.
Nice. Oh. Very nice.
And Tito's Holiday Spirits brought to you by Tito's Handmade Vodka. Tito's Handmade Vodka is America's original craft vodka distilled 6 times from 100% corn and naturally gluten-free. Come visit us at titosvodka.com.
All right, this will be a fantastic Christmas present for your mom, your chick, somebody in your life. 844-ROCK-GOD. 844-ROCK-GOD. All you got to do is let us know what we are playing homage to at 844-ROCK-GOD. It's a comedy movie, well-liked by the masses. You call in, you win. No one can stop you. You're the winner. It's your Christmas. You're the king of the world. God bless you. God bless us all, everyone.
Yes.
844-ROCK-GOD. Call in and win. We'll be right back. This is Bennington.
Bennington. Nothing will be the same ever again.
Raw Dog 99, Sirius XM's Comedy Club.
Gail and I were just talking about during the break some when you get locked into a character actor.
And you're just like, this is my guy now.
You know who was kind of my guy and then he blew up? And no, here's the thing. I didn't even know whether I dug him or hated him. Was Oscar Isaac. And now that he's becoming big Star Wars guy, I'm really thrown off.
Yeah, well, that changes everything. You kind of have to keep him. They can't get too big.
They can't become a superstar.
Because then everybody appreciates them at that point.
And that's not the point.
No.
Oscar, this is about me and you, not you and the world.
He's Star Wars guy, and he's going to be X-Men guy. He's the main villain in the next X-Men movie.
Good. That I'm glad because nobody will see that. But the Star Wars, everybody's going to say.
Oh, the entire world.
It's going to do over, I'm going to say it, and I don't mind saying it, it's going to do over $10 million.
You think? 10?
I know so. Trust me on this. There's one thing I know. It's how much money Star Wars is going to make.
If it's 10, I'm going to be really impressed.
We are doing the Tito's Holiday Specials here. They've been great so far. Today's is great. I'm not going to lie to you, though. Tomorrow blew me away.
That's your favorite one thus far, you think?
It's not so much as my favorite one. It's just that there's an impression in there that's so weird, and I can't believe it gets pulled off. I'll just say that. But today, we will be playing this. When we come back, tell us what movie we're paying homage to, and you'll be the big, big winner.
Tito's Holiday Spirit is brought to you by Tito's Handmade Vodka, which is America's original craft vodka, distilled 6 times from 100% corn and naturally gluten-free. Come visit us at titosvodka.com.
And now, it's time for Tito's Holiday Spirit.
Listen as the Bennington Show players reenact the holiday classics of yesteryear.
And soon, it is right before Christmas. And everybody is getting ready for that big, big sleigh ride on the night of the 24th, Christmas Eve. You see, all the toys Santa brings are made by these elves. Seems elves have that certain knack for toy making. All except for this one misfit.
Tito, aren't you finished painting that yet? There's a pile up a mile wide behind you. What's eating you, boy?
Not happy in my work, I guess.
What?
I just don't like to make toys.
Well, if that's all, then what? You don't like to make toys?
No.
Tito doesn't like to make toys.
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 Shame on you. Mind telling me what you do want to do?
Well, sir, someday I'd like to make the first American original craft vodka.
Vodka?
Well, I've been studying. It's fascinating. I've been looking into building my own copper pot stills and condensers, really thinking about incorporating the boutique wine concept into the spirit industry.
Now listen, you're an elf, and elves make toys. 10-minute break. Not for you, Tito. Finish the job or you're fired.
Why am I such a misfit? I am not just a nitwit. You can't fire me. I quit. Seems I don't fit in.
All right. I'm not familiar with this one, but if you are, 844 Rock God, 844 Rock God. Mark in Nashville, you got an answer?
Yeah, I think I've heard this one. Would that be Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer?
Correct.
Congratulations, buddy.
Woo! You win Song of December, signed by Mr. Paul Anka for his Christmas album.
That's a beautiful Christmas album.
That's great. Love it. And Tito's Holiday Spirits brought to you by Tito's Handmade Vodka. It's America's original craft vodka, distilled 6 times from 100% corn and naturally gluten-free. Come visit us at titosvodka.com.
That was a good one. I like that.
Solid. I felt bad for little Tito.
Well, I did too, but I know that later he ends up doing pretty good for himself.
Oh, yeah. 95 rating? Wine enthusiast?
Forget it. Forget it.
Double gold medal?
Janice Trophy? World's best vodka tonic?
In the world. The best vodka tonic.
Everything
in the world.
Works out just fine for young Tito.
I guess I'm just so fitting. I think that show was like great for other elves that didn't know whether they fit in or not. They could watch the show and decide whether they do.
Really look up to, to Tito.
To Tito. And fit in with him. And they could end up being like the water pistol that shoots jelly.
Exactly.
Who's going to want that? I don't know. Every kid in the world?
Sounds great.
Nobody wants a Charlie in the box.
Who wouldn't want that?
Of course.
Bombles bounce. That was my favorite part of it.
Yeah.
Anything to do with the bomble. The Holderness family is back, and this is I would actually go so far as this. The Holderness family is so annoying that Anthony would approve of a black home invasion on this family. They're just the worst people ever.
They became famous, I think it was actually two Christmases ago, when they had a viral video that was like Christmas jammies.
Yeah.
It was every one of your coworkers and your like grandmother was sharing it, and now they just won't
fucking
stop. It's so terrible. And then they use their Christmas song like their Christmas card. You know, these people who tell you what's happened a year in review for our family. Little Timmy's doing this and blah, blah, blah.
You know how they make their living? Helping other families make viral videos. You pay them money.
They're consultants?
Yes. Yeah, they're consultants in the viral video business.
Yes, they went into the viral video business.
Awful.
And they're the fucking worst.
All right, go ahead and play it just a little bit.
Let's look back 2015 and appreciate all that we've done and seen. Now Lola's on her first basketball team. She's
Stop it. All right, here's my prediction. This is a guy that's going to kill his family and then himself someday.
Yes.
First he'll stack them like firewood, and then he'll put the gun in his mouth.
And later in the video, their location becomes very disturbing.
All right.
It might be a little familiar to you.
All right, let's see. Let's keep playing it.
Fun with the kids, they did everything at swim meet. She couldn't stop sweating.
He learned
how to climb up walls, and he also learned how to slide down halls, and he learned how to draw and decorate. And
how many girlfriends do you have?
Eight.
Daddy, pretty busier, no doubt. He tried a breast pump, he got blown out. He went into labor, that was pretty fun.
For you?
No, everyone. And he got a hernia from singing Adele. And they ripped us on SNL.
Matt Lauer asked a question that I puked on him. But my kids don't respect me.
Let's all get help.
Oh, come on.
Look where they are.
Let's all get help.
Where, Stanley, how close is that to your place?
That is 50 feet down.
So they're trying to fucking steal your
They are stealing the location of Smoking with Chris.
What are these, Connecticut people?
They must be.
They seem like Connecticut people.
They must be.
You know, am I crazy too with the jammies? It's almost like it's family porn somehow. Like for people that are in the whole families.
Yeah, exactly. Check this out. Look at my family. It's bragging.
The holderness are just pieces of human garbage.
That isn't even a real name.
Yeah, they made it up. They're fake. But soon you'll see them. They're like right in front of the giant Christmas lights.
Cocksucker.
No.
Where we've all seen. There they are. There they are.
How do we not see them?
Merry Christmas.
Look, is that where you get your buttered rolls?
Oh, come, this is bullshit, holderness.
It is.
Oh, that family.
They blew you away, too.
No, they didn't.
It's better than yours.
No. That went more viral.
Okay, so subscribe.
They make me sick.
Now they're all in Kourtney Kardashian's ass.
Oh, God damn it. That was the ass that I was going to be in.
Hey, Bob, what's up, dude?
I just wanted to thank y'all. You know, I've been really down and not in a Christmas spirit at all so far this year. And of course, Stanley's faux pas, and you guys have to worry about him. That even made it worse.
Yeah.
But the Tito's bit has turned me around.
You're feeling Christmassy.
It's really the holiday spirit. Christmas.
Yeah, yeah, I'm with it.
I'm going to force myself to be in a good mood this year and just be all Christmassy, too.
Yeah, let's all get helped.
Let's all get helped.
No, don't sing that song.
Yeah.
No,
let's all get helped.
Now, Chris Stanley, he's a scroper. All here comes his friend JoJo. Is that Vito drinking Tito's? Here comes Gail. What the hell? Let's all get helped.
Yeah. Let's all get helped.
Oh, my God. Well, I got another fucking goddamn enemy on the list, the holderness, is for fucking ripping me off.
Last summer, Joe had chlamydia, so he...
I went and got help.
I got help.
They're just fucking pieces of garbage.
You know, like, when no one else is around, kids are sleeping, he's just looking at his wife. Honey, this has got to fucking work. We're in over our fucking dicks with this mortgage. You fucking put on the jammies, bounce your titties, and sing about being a fucking elf. Don't give a fuck what you gotta do. But we're fucking dying here. I'm fucking drowning. You're gonna get fucking elfed with me. Everyone's gonna fucking think this works. I don't want to fucking go back to my job anymore. I'll kill you and the fucking kids. I'm not fucking kidding you. I'll fucking cut your throats. But go get your fucking elf suit on. Let's do this thing. Wake the fucking kids up. We're going to drive down to Stanley's fucking buttered roll place. Fuck. He fucking moved scope bro shirts like there was no tomorrow. Fuck. Fuck you, man. Just fucking just screaming at his wife. It always fucking turns out that way. It was like fucking the family that you think has got it together.
Just
he's
dark.
Just fucking just taking fucking bills and stuffing them in his mouth. Eat these fucking things because I got no fucking else to pay him.
He's just making his kids do 100 takes. No, it's not all of the above. It's D, all of the above. How many times did I tell you?
The fuck is wrong with you dyslexic bitches?
You're embarrassing us.
Yeah, just like at your fucking swim meet. Fatty, I gotta look out there and see you with fatty ass and a fucking Speedo. You're an embarrassment. Daddy's fucking dying. Where's my medicine at? Maybe you don't want to live in a fucking box in the street? Then put on the fucking elf bit. Eric in Hoboken. No joking.
What's up, Boddington, Bob?
Hey, buddy.
What's up? These videos, I just get, like, douche chills. They just, it's so bad.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, do you think, like, in, like, 5 or 6 or 7, 8, however old those kids are when they're, like, 16, 17, they're going to be rapping about how they get, like, deweys and, you know.
Oh, really, yeah, they'll be fucking and sitting in their fucking rehab, and they'll be like, yeah, then the old man would make us put on elf fucking costumes. My little balls inside this thing, and all the other kids were teasing me about it. I was a late bloomer, and that could be fucking devastating. So finally, I just tried to stop the fucking pain. I called Spanish Johnny.
Spanish Johnny, he'll come, you know, hook you up.
Spanish Johnny will be there in a heartbeat. Spanish Johnny will never let you down. Spanish Johnny takes away the pain. Merry Christmas to you, my friend.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Frankie Angel. Chris, do you know what hospital you're going to for vacation this year?
Looking to upgrade NYU. Mount Sinai, not so
it's
nice.
It's Christmas Eve, Chris. You're in the drunk tank. An old man looked at you, said you won't see another one.
Oh, no.
It's time to stitch your head and wipe the puke off you. They got cars big as bars.
They got rivers of gold.
Fuck that. I haven't listened to that song.
But the wind goes right through you. No place for the old. Well, you're going to listen to it tomorrow.
I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah. You can open one of your fucking liquid presents.
Oh, jeez.
It's Christmas Eve, Chris. Just look and see how our people are doing.
Yeah.
I have one of the guys doing it in there.
Mm-hmm. No, they're signed in.
Okay. Are they bringing them in?
They're not we should probably break one last time.
All right, let's break one last time. When we come back, who do we got, Chris?
Mr. Jim Florentine and Mr. Don Jameson.
Very, very funny. They got a brand new album out there right now.
Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6. It's available now on iTunes.
It makes the last 5 volumes look like shit. And that's a Ron Bennington fucking plug. Right back. Bennington Show.
You're listening to Bennington on Raw Dog 99, Sirius XM's Comedy Club.
Chris Stanley, it's not often we get a couple of rock gods stopping in here together, but this is exciting.
Jim Florentine and Don Jameson are in studio, and their new album, Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6, is available now on iTunes, on Twitter, at Real Don Jameson, and at Mr. Jim Florentine.
These things are so damn funny and so embarrassing and humiliating and everything all at the same time.
It hit number 2 on iTunes. There's no reason for that. I mean, my 5-year-old son laughs at all the tracks, so it should not be number 2 on the comedy iTunes charts.
Believe me when I tell you, I try not to laugh because it's an antisocial thing that's happening. Someone who's unsuspecting is getting their kidneys kicked in and having their day wasted, and I don't know why it's funnier than any material that any comedian could sit down and write.
Well, it's a little different where it's an incoming. It's almost like a heckler and
you're
a comedian
right.
buries the
right
heckler.
About
like,
that.
They started it.
Yeah.
They started it by calling our house, so then we're going
to
mess with them.
But they are doing their job. I mean, we have to think about
and
this.
So are we. We're
no
immature.
One is, yeah, that is true. That is true. But no one sets out to be a telemarketer. I don't think. I don't think it's any child's dream.
It's a lifelong dream of a child. One day.
But what makes it even, the other level of comedy is that there's two middle-aged men sitting in a house in New Jersey for weeks on end recording these calls and putting them out.
That is, that's the sad part of this. And the fact is, the Odd Couple could have not worked if there was two Oscars. And yet, in this case, it's true.
Yes.
It's Oscar and Oscar living comfortably. Now, you guys do live together.
No.
Oh, that didn't happen. There was a short period of time where you lived together, right?
No, we never did.
I thought there was a breakup that both you were in simultaneous breakups.
No, that did happen about a year ago.
Yeah.
Both of our chicks, our relationships blew up.
Yeah.
So then we were just sitting in our houses alone. We're like, what do we want to do? I don't know.
Yeah.
I got nothing going on. Do you? No. All right, let's do it. Let's wait for phone.
Yeah, we had a lot of rage and we had to take it out on somebody.
So you, when is the time that you know you're going to get calls? Is there a time of day?
Anywhere between like around 8 a.m. to about 8 p.m.
Right.
Pretty much in that 12-hour window.
So you guys have got to be together for 12 hours.
Yep. Just sit there and just wait for that phone to ring and root for it. And get mad if it's one of our friends.
You're like, dude, call back next week. We're recording an album. Yeah. We're in the studio right now.
So what are you doing in between? You're watching movies, playing video games?
Yeah, whatever. We're just hanging out, listening to music. Yeah.
You can't listen to your music because it's going to be way too loud for you to possibly hear the phone ring.
We keep it low to make sure. But yeah, we just hang out. We order lunch and we just sit there and do some writing or whatever. And
you know, I'm glad you brought up, and by the way, the TV show that they do with Eddie Trunk is fantastic because it's guys who really love music and love talking about it. But I know you're both huge Sabbath fans. I don't know whether you saw the TV show Fargo, but they use war pigs in a scene there that was one of the best things I ever saw.
Amazing.
We didn't talk about that after it happened. But I'm watching this and I'm going, why hasn't anyone ever used this like this?
Yeah,
before?
I had that same exact thought where, of course, this is such a dramatic, like, it like
scary ass
fucking brought so much
time.
Energy. And I was like, that's crazy this hasn't been used.
Yeah.
I don't think it's ever been used.
No.
Well, they just used a Pantera song, I'm Broken, in a Hardee's commercial, which is really great. So now, you know, you drive past fast food restaurants and you just sing in Pantera.
Yeah. You know, they did. I know Eddie Trunk must be happy today because they did the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and they finally let in Deep Purple. And
Cheap Trick.
And Cheap Trick went in as well. You guys are big Cheap Trick fans.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is their first time in the ballot, too.
Yeah.
And they got in.
Well, you know, I know why, too, because somebody that was pushing them is a big deal, and he said he was going to lock it in when he did my show, and that was Little Steven. Little Steven said, I brought up Cheap Trick, and he was like this. Yeah.
Oh, there. I'll take
it. Oh, I'm in it. Because he's the one who got Joan Jett in. Like, he's going to pick one person a year and then go, like, be their lawyer and battle for them. Right. But Cheap Trick is an unbelievable band and still sounds great, by the way.
Absolutely.
Just saw them a few months ago. And, you know, they're cool. They're like, you know, their manager's like, if you want to make a request, I'm like, from what album? Again, any song from any album, and they'll play it.
Is that right?
Yeah, and that's like an hour before the show. So it's not like they're even rehearsing it. You just go, okay, can they play He's a Whore from the first album?
Right.
Yeah, they're going to, okay, they'll play it.
Yeah, because somebody even told me that they don't, because they played together for so long, that they don't need to rehearse at all. They still do a lot of gigs. They still do a couple hundred gigs a year, which is amazing.
They're constantly out there. Is Bunny Carlos' son still playing drums for them?
No, it's Rick Nielsen's son, actually.
Oh, I'm sorry, Rick Nielsen's son.
Yeah, his son Dax.
Yeah. Right. He played, yeah. I wonder if Bun will be there at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I know he had some health issues or something like that.
I hope he shows up for that.
Yeah, it would be cool.
Yeah.
He was always great because he was like the anti-rock star. He looked like he was 20 years older than every other guy in the band.
Oh, yeah.
Had a lit cigarette in his mouth while he was playing the drums.
Well, that was the thing about that band. Two guys looked like they were beautiful pop stars that could have been in the Junior Beatles. And then the other two are literally freaks that are coming out of some almost like they were drawn by the Keep On Trucking guy. You know, remember those kind of cartoons from the 70s? You're like, I don't even know where that would fit in.
If you look at every album, every single album is the same exact setup. The two pretty boys on the front and the ugly dudes on the back.
Right. They also had a thing when they popped out of like doing four albums in a row that probably would have been set for a lifetime. And they did it like in 2 years. It was like there was like four albums in 2 years. And you go back to listen to them now and you're like, I can't believe at the speed that they were putting this shit out. And at that time, I don't even think they were popular. They were still like an opening act.
A lot of those bands back in the 70s would put one out like every 9 months.
Yeah.
It was crazy, and just phenomenal records, like Zeppelin, touring. Sabbath, yeah. Lynyrd Skynyrd, all those great acts from the 70s. And, in the middle of touring, too, get off tour for like a week, and then go in the studio for 3 weeks, do an album, go back on tour.
Right.
And they had most people think, they just had the one song, I Want You to Want Me, but they actually had a lot of hits, man.
No, there's plenty of radio.
Yeah, the Dream Police, The Flame.
Yeah, and it's real radio-friendly. They should have been fucking even bigger. You know, but a lot of it had to do with being from the Midwest is not the best thing from your fucking career. They fuck with you if you're from the Midwest.
Yeah. And then, 70s, they hit like late 77, 78. But then when the 80s came around, they weren't good looking enough to be like a hair band on MTV.
Yeah.
They just weren't handsome. So they just kind of.
Well, MTV also wanted to invent their own stars. You know what I mean? Like they did not want to adapt people that were already out there.
Yeah.
So they basically found pretty people and said, take them into the studio, please. And we're making a TV show here. It was like the Monkees were running the whole time. Who else went in, Chris?
NWA also went in.
Well, they had a big year with that movie, right?
Yeah, the movie was basically.
I haven't seen it yet. Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it. I've heard bad things about it.
I heard good things. There's people talking about it might even get an Oscar now.
That's crazy.
Oh, you heard bad things from people who actually were in that world.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I'm sure it's all lies.
Like the people in the people who are in the hip-hop world.
Yeah, that were there at the time said none of this shit happened.
Right.
But that happens with movies. Like, the way to hate a movie is to know anything about the subject matter.
Yeah, like Rockstar with Marky Wahlberg.
Yeah.
It's a story about Tim Ripper Owens who took the place of Rob Halford and Judas Priest as the singer.
Right.
But by the time it got onto the screen, it was just, maybe one thing in the whole movie was truthful.
Yeah.
Like he was from Akron and that was it.
The only thing, the only thing was true. And then he was also dating Jennifer Aniston.
Yeah.
Who really looks like a rock chick.
But with any of those movies, I think with that movie, they were upset that certain people got left out. And I always think that's funny when that happens when it's like within the same generation or two. Like those people are still around being like, what the fuck? I was the guy who found that band that's going to be the worst.
Yeah,
you're completely cut out of the whole story.
Right. In Eazy-E's case, it's a mistake to die. Just you want to be around when this. And then one of them had their kid play him too, right?
Oh, yeah.
Bunny Carlos? Bunny Carlos was in that?
I think so.
All right, who else went in?
Chicago.
The band?
The band.
Or the city? Because the city is amazing. Yeah. That band's been around so long and has always had their own fans, which were always kids that were in marching bands. Were always big Chicago
fans.
Because they were so musical.
You could hear horns.
Yeah.
Like kids that were in a marching band went, holy shit, did you hear that? That's a fucking trombone right there.
I play that.
That was amazing.
Yeah, they were heavy. They were a lot heavier in the early days.
Yeah.
And then when the 80s came and they let Peter Cetera do all those those ballads,
Sorry. Yeah. What? Yeah, they immediately went into rom-com movie themes. You know what I mean? That was it's a very smart career move to start to sing those type of songs and get them out there. Bryan Adams. I don't feel like you could watch one of these things without Bryan Adams showing up with his gravelly.
Bryan Adams. It was the Peter DeBerg.
Peter DeBerg was all over that.
Those, About Last Night or those Brad Pack movies.
Yeah.
He did a lot of those too. Yeah.
Joe Cocker tried it for a little while at the end of his career. Up where we belong. Suddenly it's wedding themes and proms. Who else, Chris?
And finally, Steve Miller.
It's hard to believe Steve Miller wasn't there before.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
It's a weird one.
Now, who got left out?
Well, Deep Purple's in, too.
Deep Purple is in, yeah.
Well, Ritchie Blackmore's starting to play rock again after, like, 20 years, so maybe that's why they said, hey, hopefully he'll show up at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Oh, you know what? Eddie Trunk actually said there were so many people in that band that he doesn't know how they're all going to fit on the stage over the years.
Well, the drummer even said, he goes, I don't know who's getting in, but it's no secret that there's people that have been in this band who still hate other members of the band. So
that's kind of fun, though.
It might end up in fisticuffs if we're all on stage together.
Well, that's one of those things where they just bring John Mayer into play. I don't know why, but whatever happened, we ever watched that show, there's
no
John
Grohl.
Mayer.
They'll bring Grohl in. Dave Grohl is the go-to guy. He'll play Deep Purple classics, and he's going to play drums, guitar, bass, and sing all by himself.
And organ, because John Lord passed away, so he'll be on the organ.
Yeah, that was probably the last big Hammond organ in a band, where you listen to those early Deep Purple things, and you're just hearing this rolling sound. And you know, it's not even like he's playing, just running up and down that. Fucking, it's a great band, though. It was really, really one of those bands that was at the beginning of whatever, you know, a new sound was. So to take this long is crazy to me. Who else didn't they let in?
Chaka Khan was not let in.
Everybody knows that Feel For You song. What? Who else?
The Cars.
Cars is crazy.
Yeah,
Cars
why
belong
the
there.
Cars be in?
The JBs.
Well, that's a backup band for James Brown. That's a tough move to get in.
Los Lobos.
Yeah, I mean, come on.
One hit, right?
Yeah.
And that's not rock.
Los Lobos. I guess it's Hispanic rock, Mexican rock.
Latin rock.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like a band's... Like, the Cars probably had, they put maybe five records out. Maybe three of them were good. Like, Rage Against the Machine comes up next year. They put out three records. They're going to get in first ballot. And it's like, I don't know, you put only three out. I need a more of a body of work. They're one of my favorite bands, but I want at least five or six before you go into Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Anybody can pump out three great ones, and they just call it a day.
Yeah, but what about if you make a record that changes everything? Because fucking Nine Inch Nails... I remember being shocked when I heard that band. Like, I don't even know how I don't even know where this music's coming from.
Yeah, well, Rage did the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, with the rap metal and stuff like that. Yeah, Nine Inch Nails, definitely.
Yeah, and they got left out this year, Nine Inch Nails.
Nine Inch Nails did not get in this year.
No.
Yeah, and I know Eddie was big on them because they really did. You're right, Ron, man. They invented a genre of music, industrial music.
Well,
so.
I remember thinking, what are they? Have they made their fucking drums out of metal and they're beating it with a hammer? I'm like, when I first heard it, I did not even know how this was fucking happening. Who else didn't get in?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes was an enormous band for many years. Yeah.
And finally, the Spinners. The Spinners didn't make
it. The Detroit Spinners first, and then they had to drop it to be the Spinners. Yeah. You know, if we're not going to sit there and say Rubber Band Man is one of the greatest songs of all time, why are we doing this? Why do we have a Hall of Fame?
Why do we exist?
All right, somebody is on right here who probably is going to find a way not to be happy about this. It is a gentleman that you fellas know pretty well, Mr. Eddie Trunk.
Wow.
What's up, boys?
Well, they're all excited. You know, they got this new album out.
Yeah, well, why? What's not to be a sixth volume of that sort of comedic brilliance? There's no reason.
That's why I'm saying, you know, this is what Jim is getting around to. He's put out more albums than Rage Against the Machine.
That's right.
And the Cars.
And the
I
Cars
I should be
together.
In the prank phone call Hall of Fame. Me and Dom put six records out.
Hey, all joking aside, one of the first things those guys, when I met them like 15 years ago, they gave me, I think, was the first telemarketers record, and I loved it. I mean, that was one of the reasons why I was like, yeah, I could kind of hang with these guys.
I have fucking
sort of
physically
stuff,
hurt from listening to these records, and I wish that it went. And then I've played it for, like, people in my family who have no idea what any of this is. And you'll just see people, once they fall into the rhythm of it, will die. And it's embarrassing to laugh that hard. I mean, it's not a comfortable feeling to sit there laughing at these things. But
my five-year-old son made the record. He's on a track called Luke. And I told him, I said, Luke, tell all your friends in school. He goes, no, I don't want to tell him. I'm embarrassed. He's embarrassed and he's five.
That's great.
He's embarrassed to say he's on
this. I gave my buddy a copy, and he texts me. He goes, my wife wants to know if she's supposed to feel uncomfortable while she's listening to this. I go, exactly. She's got it.
But it would be one thing if you could just feel uncomfortable. But why are you fucking feeling uncomfortable and then donkey laughing at the same time? That's the part I don't understand. Eddie, are you super happy about this year's Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
Well, I don't know if you know this, Ron, but they made me a voter this year, and I actually had, for the first time in my life after screaming for 25 years, a vote, and I had three of my five picks make it. So if I could pick football that good on Sunday, I'd be all right.
Wow, so, Eddie Trunk sells out, joins the machine. I love this.
No, I didn't sell out, but I mean, it would have been pretty stupid for me after screaming for 25 years about it when offered an opportunity to try to help make a change to deny it. So
who made the offer to you?
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Their office called me and said, you know, we want to know if you want to be a voter and be on the voting committee. Now, I don't get to pick who's eligible.
Right.
I just get to vote on the people that they decide are going to be eligible that year. And I did pick
Chicago and NWA.
He wrote in the Winery Dogs.
I picked Chicago, Nine Inch Nails, Yes, Deep Purple, and Cheap Trick were the five. You can only pick five. So wow. I got three of my five then.
And who didn't he pick?
Mr. Corporate.
Who didn't he pick?
I didn't pick Steve Miller, which was a tough call, and I didn't pick the Cars, which was a really tough call. But I thought Nine Inch Nails because they basically helped create a whole new genre. I mean, the number one criteria they will tell you for induction is influence. And even though I'm more of a Cars fan probably than a Nine Inch Nails fan, especially the early Cars records, you can't deny that Nine Inch Nails created a new genre of music. I think it's absurd. Yes, didn't get in. Yes, should have been. I mean, and it's beyond comprehension that Deep Purple wasn't there 25 years ago. But
right.
The big shocker for me is that Cheap Trick made it. This was their first time on the ballot. So, I mean, I was pleasantly surprised.
Well, you know, out of everybody, is Cheap Trick keeps touring. And to still sound that good after doing this for so long, it's kind of a miracle.
Yeah, I mean, Robin Zander is just ageless in his singing. Yeah. They're three quarters the original band still, and they do tour constantly. And you know, their influence is pretty wide. Like metal fans love Cheap Trick, like alternative guys love Cheap Trick. You know, straight up rock people. So I thought it was great they went in first ballot, but I was shocked that they did. And just something you guys were saying before about Dave Grohl, you know, just coming in to play for anybody. The guitar player and all that will always be Tom Morello too.
Basically, right, Tom Morello.
Yeah, Dave Grohl or Tom Morello. That's very involved and plugged into everything.
Yeah. But, you know, it's kind of cool about them is those are guys that actually love music, you know, all kinds of music. And surprising that people don't talk about that more, that most musicians don't even like break down the genres the way fans do. You know what I mean? Like Ozzy loves the fucking Beatles, loves David Bowie, loves classical music. And you're like, what? Really? And yeah, those guys are like listening to music on a different level than most of
us. Tom Morello's son is named Rhodes after Randy Rhodes.
Uh-huh.
You wouldn't think that he was influenced by Randy Rhodes by Tom's playing.
Right.
And he's a huge Randy Rhodes fan.
He was also a huge Kiss fan. He's just, mm-hmm. Those guys, they're almost, they love music on almost a subconscious level. It's like the reason that we do, you know, because we don't write music, we also don't even listen to it.
Yeah, now musicians, they'll pull from every kind of genre of music. They're not, you know, the fans are very territorial. I mean, the only bands that are territorial are like those, you know, the Norwegian death metal band to burn the churches down. They're the only ones who are extreme about what they do.
It's
but everybody else is like, yeah, we like a little rhythm and blues. We like a little this, a little of that.
It's kind of like we were talking about this with comedy as well, like comedians. That people will assume that if you do a certain type of comedy that you wouldn't enjoy, respect, or want to go out and see a comedy that is completely different.
Sometimes
yours.
You like it even more because you wouldn't have written that joke in your whole life.
Right.
You know? So you sit down and crack up.
I'm not knocking either of those guys, and I know them both, and especially Tom, but the only thing that I say is that there's a lot of other musicians that feel that way as well, and I just feel that it's such a copycat industry that every single time anybody needs a go-to token rock musician, it's one of those two guys.
Sure.
It's like, you know, there are other guys out there. I mean, Dave Grohl's on the Country Music Awards. He's on the hip. I mean, it's like you can just see in every boardroom, every network out there, oh, wait, we need a token rock guy. Call Dave Grohl. I mean, it's just like, it's unbelievable, and it'd be nice to see some other people get a shot every once in a while. It's not Dave's fault.
But, yeah, do you think those other people are available or know that they would even want it, you know? Or, you know, how do you get Eddie Van Halen out of his house to go do something else, you know?
Well, you're not going to get him to play guitar with the Muppets. But Grohl will do it.
Yeah, Grohl will do anything. He doesn't give a fuck. This is great. And he really is enjoying it.
Yeah.
It's not like he's like. But you know how many of those guys that end up loving jazz? You know, those guys that play guitar can really relate to fucking jazz horn players. It's always amazing to me. Those guys are starting to bring up Coltrane.
Speaking of jazz, Ronnie, I just had him in my studio last week, and he just put out this documentary. Robert from Metallica did a documentary on Jaco Pastorius, which, you know, is a renowned jazz fusion bass player.
That's the guy that killed his wife in Africa, right?
No, that's
what?
Pastorius.
That's Oscar.
Yeah, oh, Oscar Pastorius. That was fucking fast.
I thought he played bass, too.
It was almost a little too quick for the room. Everyone's like, oh, yeah. I think he did. I think he did. Jaco Pastorius was a phenomenal bass player. But when I was down in Florida, he was like sleeping on beaches and basically just fucking almost panhandling. Because of
if you watch the doc, I mean, it's a tremendously tragic story because the guy was the guy, and his influence spread into rock music, and he played with Joni Mitchell and with all these different people, and he was pretty much considered like the greatest bass player alive. And, you know, drugs and stuff, he just took a downward spiral, and at the end of his career, he's sleeping in parks and homeless, and he died, which I didn't even know, because he was he was just homeless living in a park in New York City, and he went to a club to see Carlos Santana, who he knew and had played with, and he wandered into the club, and he was just so kind of out of it that they tried to remove him from the club. They didn't know who he was. Yeah. He wouldn't go, and he literally got beaten to death that night, and then that's how he died. I mean, it's just tragic, but it's an amazing story. And Robert from, there's a guy, you know, Rob, the bass player Metallica, crazy fan of Jaco, that he actually put 6 years of his life into making this movie. So there's a connection you wouldn't expect, but, you know, it's an example of that.
Eddie, how come you're not making documentaries left and right, one after another?
I'm just trying to pay the bills, man. I'm trying to stay
alive. Please, you got nothing but money. Seriously.
We're working on VH1 Classic money.
I'm walking on a plane about to go to Fort Wayne, Indiana, so that's all you need to know.
No, here's the thing. No one does a metal show anywhere in America without Eddie walking out and introducing it.
Me and Eddie are really good friends, and the most conversations we have, but not even about music or friendship, is we better make enough money this year in SAG to pay for our family's health insurance. Because we're always, if you don't make a certain amount in that, then you have to pay out of pocket. And it's huge. It goes it goes from about $20,000 to about $3,000. There's about a $17,000 difference.
Right.
So that's all we talk about.
It's all about.
So that's why he's going on a plane to Fort Wayne right now.
Ed, Jim said that next year Rage Against the Machine is eligible for Hall of Fame.
Yeah, yeah. 25 years.
He thinks it's a shoo-in first ballot. What do you think?
Probably, yeah, just because of the political angle and because they love Tom. But I tell you, I was shocked that Nine Inch Nails didn't go immediately.
Me too.
A little curveball. You know, I thought that, you know, there's the, you know, Trent is such a, you know, happening sort of like, you know, guy to the, you just have to look at what Rolling Stone likes. And you'd be like, well, how the heck did Nine Inch Nails not go? So I think what's happened is, yes, Exit Row is fine. Thank you. I'm sorry. I'm going off plane.
No, you're not in first class?
No. Someone else. He's paying.
You just said it yourself.
Yeah. When the company pays.
Oh, yeah. That's how I am. I'll scream for first class unless it's my credit card. And I'm like, anywhere's good.
Yeah.
Put me anywhere. If not, I'm like, this is outrageous.
Yeah, I'm not paying.
I just got my reservation.
I'm not paying $40 to upgrade to emergency exit aisle. We're all sitting in the back and coach.
Take my chances.
I think what's happening now is they're letting people like me vote, and as people get in, they let voters in, and like, you know, as voters, like now Lars has a vote because Metallica's in, and Lars is a huge Deep Purple fan. So all these people eventually can help change the tide as they open it up a little bit. I mean, there was a press release out. They got rid of a lot of the other voters. They made a big change at the Hall of Fame, like in the last year or two, where they let go of some of the older voters and brought in new people, and then opened the door to new people, like, you know, newer artists and people like me. So hopefully, as they continue to do that and evolve, we'll start to see more rock acts get in. I'm not going to have much to complain about anymore with Rush, Fitz, Alice Cooper, Deep Purple, Cheap Trick finally going in.
It takes some of the fun out of it.
I might need a new...
Yeah.
I like the bitching better. You know what I mean? I really miss the Rush and Kiss fans, especially. They used to call every year and be furious. Now, who cares? They're in.
Well, the best was Alex Lifeson's blah, blah, blah speech.
Yeah.
When Rush got in.
Yeah.
It was just such a slam to the whole thing. Just blah, blah, blah for 3 minutes. And two other band members standing uncomfortably behind him.
Yeah, it felt longer. Was it only 3 minutes? Because it felt like it was 18 minutes. Eddie, how many people are voting on this?
I don't know what the total voting committee is. But here's the thing. It still tainted to me. Because it's still, when you look at a band like Deep Purple, who waited over 25 years after being eligible to get in, it still enrages me. So don't worry, there's still plenty of venom. But I mean, it's hard to figure out. It's like it'll always be tainted. Kiss will always be tainted. Rush will always be tainted because they ignored them. When they're letting these bands in, you know, Red Hot Chili Peppers or Guns N' Roses first time eligible, and they're making bands like Deep Purple wait 30 years. Come on, there's still a lot to scream about. So that's my take, at least. I still have a lot, you know, I still think there's a lot of issues that need to be resolved.
Even Black Sabbath, they made, I think it was like 6-7 years, something like that, before they went in. Maybe even 10. Ozzy at some point said, take me off the ballot. I don't want to do it anymore.
And that's when they came around and said, all right, forget it, you're in.
Van Halen didn't go first ballot. I mean, you got to be kidding me. So it's just, there's still so much wrong with it, and but at least there's some hope for maybe some positive changes now.
I don't know. It's all the way in Cleveland anyway. I mean, other than talking about who goes in, then that ends the year for me. You know what I mean? I don't go around thinking about it throughout the year.
You don't think about Cleveland year-round?
No, and I don't separate my music that way. Like, here's the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame music, and here's the people who haven't gotten in yet.
We're going to have to start, if they keep this up, we're going to have to start finding other halls of fame to get mad about.
Yeah. Well, you want to join me with Pete Rose, I like to have that fight for no apparent reason.
Hey, I just hung up the phone with Mike Piazza literally before I called you guys, and he's been snubbed by the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame now, to great outrage from fans for, like, 3 years eligible. So that's coming up again, and if he doesn't go this year, I mean, I think it's going to be an all-out riot in New York because that's just absolutely ludicrous. The greatest hitting catcher of all time in Major League Baseball, and they're putting him on the sidelines because they think he might, you know, by association, because he came up in the Royce era. I mean, it's so, with zero proof of anything, it's just ridiculous.
And so, why do they put a guy like Frank Thomas in, who was in the same era, who was huge, put up those unbelievable numbers no one's ever seen before? Why does he get in the first time?
Well, to me, it should only be, and although it's not fair, just like when you're speeding, if you get caught, that's it. If you're not caught, you get to drive home as fast as you want. So anybody who actually got busted for this, I'm sorry, it's not fair, but you got popped. The other guy didn't. That's the way to work. That's the way it's played. Does this kind of thing enrage Piazza, or does he not care one way or another?
I think he thinks that it sucks because he's just being guilty, you know, made guilty by association. I mean, there's zero, not one shred of evidence of him having ever done anything except for the fact that he had unbelievable numbers for a catcher. But the thing I think for him is that, you know, his dad, it was a huge part of his career, who's up there now. I mean, in age, I think for him, he wants to make sure that this happens so that his dad can be there for it. I think that's probably one of the most important things. And, you know, fortunately, all signs point to it finally happening this year. Even some of the early information is that it could happen finally this year. So that'll be a good thing. But, I mean, it's just ridiculous. I mean, they literally have nothing on this guy, but they're keeping him on the sidelines just because of the era he played in.
Yeah, but the baseball voters are really the strangest of all. I mean, they're hardcore. Some guys will never vote for anyone first ballot because somebody never got 100%. So, I mean, I don't know. You don't have to be a fan of the team. You hear the name Nolan Ryan. Who would ever say no? You know what I mean? It's just crazy to me. The reasoning that they give up, they're going, hey.
Now, who votes on that?
It's mainly sports writers with that, and sports writers of the nerdiest statistical type.
Yeah, old crusty guys that don't like any records being broken.
Yeah. Feel like everything
basically
has gotten ruined.
Kind of people, basically the same kind of people that had been voting in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Old crusty record executives with elitist attitudes who hated hard rock music, and now they're being phased out, and that's why I think you see some of the change. It's exactly what
you know. You're right. There's young, groovy people now voting in this.
young people like Eddie Trunk and Lars Ulrich.
Ronnie, I'm on the edge. I'm on the cutting edge of these kids today.
I know you are, man. I'm telling you, you're always right there. Eddie,
hey,
Frank, you're the best, buddy.
I get the Benjamin album release party, man. Come on, I'm on top of it.
All right, Eddie, I hope your plane doesn't crash. I really do. I hope it all works out.
Sentiment. Ronnie, thank you for that. Since we're taking off in pea soup and pouring rain, I really appreciate you.
But if anything happens, this will be
this
it.
This will be
I'll
Eddie's last interview.
Yeah, I'll have
wow.
it. Yeah.
Yes.
What a way to go down, then, with you guys and Don and Jim and the final people I've ever spoken to. On the Bennington show, it's a tremendous honor.
This will
and just play this tape at my funeral, will you?
This will be big. Like if his plane goes down, this will be big news. This will be on TMZ.
Yeah.
His last interview. So I just want to say, Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6 is on iTunes now. Get that plug in.
Number 9 on the Billboard charts, and Ed's got a connecting flight, so we have two shots of it going
great.
Down.
Perfect.
Eddie, could the last thing you ever say in your last interview just be La Bamba? Just that would be really a weird thing. See you, pal.
You guys suck.
Yeah. Isn't that funny? It's like the only time you don't feel like joking about planes is when you're getting on one. You know, the day before is fine.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when you're just taking it like this is strange.
Yeah.
This building is going up in the air.
I don't like this.
Yeah.
And he's going to Fort Wayne, so he's not on a 767.
No. No. He's lucky to. That thing, and then he said he's taking off in pea soup. Impossible to fly in this weather. Just feel like the windows open and rain is coming in and out.
God.
But then, you know, we joke, but wouldn't that be fucking great for all of us? You know, seriously, we'd be on TV tonight talking about, you know, we joked, but all this felt kind of strange.
No, we'd be the biggest dicks right now if that ever happened and this audio got out that we were just making fun of it and it really did happen.
There's people pissed at us on the internet.
Oh, yeah. We'd be like those DJs in Australia, like they called the hospital.
Oh, yeah.
That whole thing, like what piece of shit they are. How could they do that? How was it a joke? All that stuff, yeah.
That happened with that metal show. I wasn't kidding around, but, you know, when we had Janie Lane from Warren on the show, you know, he had been, he struggled for...
Yeah.
You know, decades with drugs and alcohol, but he, you know, he was real proud. He was like, you know, he was telling us, you know, off camera, I'm six weeks clean, which, you know, there's not a lot to most people, but for him, it was great. And he was doing good. He looked good. He seemed really happy in a good place. And I was just, you know, he was great on the show. And I was saying to people after, man, that would suck if like we heard 2 weeks from now, like he relapsed and we lost him. And literally 2 weeks later, he relapsed and lost him. And I told that to Lemmy from Motorhead, and he goes, so you're the one who killed him.
That is, I can't think of, somebody died after we did the last interview. Oh, it was Kevorkian.
Yeah.
So that interview, suddenly everybody, even though they hadn't thought about him in a couple years, they just went back and picked up the interview because it was the last thing they had to deal with. And you're like, well, this is kind of great, huh? This is fantastic.
Really? Yeah, I was kind of mad.
Stroke of luck.
Yeah. I was kind of mad at you guys for a while after that. Because Kevorkian was like probably one of my top favorite assisted suicide doctors.
He's up there.
Yeah.
He's got to be up there. Look, here comes somebody bringing a bunch of young ladies by.
Wow.
Doing radio.
Are you single? Any of you single? Come in. Yeah. I think Kevorkian should definitely. I don't know if he's in the Assisted Suicide Hall of Fame or not, but he should be.
Oh, I don't know if he's going
to
get first ballot.
No, you don't think so?
No, there was a lot of controversy.
Yeah.
There was a lot of controversy with him. Maybe they want to just.
Here's what happened, and this was part of that era. But a lot of those guys, they actually killed themselves when he was just sitting there reading a comic book. I mean, he just made sure it didn't go bad.
Like, but he didn't do much assisting.
Yeah, you really, to me, you've got to show up with the medication. You've got to start the drip, you know.
See, that's why I wouldn't put him in first year. I'd make him wait a couple of years.
Yeah, if you're 70 and sitting around reading comic books, it's time to go.
It is.
Yeah.
It really is. That is true that there's...
You're reading an Archie comic and you're 75.
There's a lot of jobs that don't have a Hall of Fame. And it would be kind of cool, like, if we had a presidential Hall of Fame that people could sit around and debate whether Buchanan belongs in there or not. Or you take a real short term like Jack Kennedy had.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, does he really belong there with a lot of the two-termers?
But look at the numbers he put up.
Yeah, he did put up amazing numbers, and he almost blew up the world.
I like the idea of a former president being disappointed of not getting in.
Yeah.
Like, you were already Carter. President. You're like, yeah, but I didn't get in the Hall of
Chester
Fame.
Arthur wanted so bad to be in.
I guess
Ford's not making the cut. He's not even going to make the ballot.
No.
But we kind of have that for that Hall of Fame with the Mount Rushmore, right?
Yeah.
And there was some talk about, hey, maybe we could put Reagan's face on there. And people went, you know how fucking expensive that is to do now?
Forget it.
Why don't we just go out and use that money for something good rather than have a big Reagan face for no reason?
Like, website
at the time, I guess there was enough money to go around. I don't know. But you would never do something so ridiculous.
You don't need a Reagan mountain. Yeah. We want one, but we don't need one.
Just his own mountain. Well. But I'm going to look in to get more of this. I know this. If you got fucking with telemarketers as Hall of Fame, you guys have got to go in.
Jim Florentine and Don Jameson are in studio. Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6, is available now on iTunes. And Don's performing New Year's Eve at the Funny Stop in Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. Go to funnystop.com for tickets. And Jim's performing at New Year's Eve at the Mount Airy Casino in Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania. Go to mountairycasino.com for tickets.
And this weekend, tomorrow and Saturday, Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island.
Sweet. You love that place, right?
Oh, yeah. It's great. Old school.
That is
down
real.
And dirty club.
Yeah. Real old school, and normally gets a bunch of Boston comics. So you know that that audience understands to show up and be ready for a show.
Boston comics are phenomenal. It's best comics in the country, without a doubt, coming out of Boston. Always.
Always. Well, you know, we had Barry Crimmins on earlier today.
Oh, he was in? I love him.
And he is one of the reasons why, because he started that scene, he being a comic himself, he was one of that, hey, you got to be original. Don't be doing anybody else's thing. And that has stayed in Boston. And you can't say that for many other cities, you know, where the guys will go, look, I don't care what you do, but you have to be true to your own personality, you know?
Oh, yeah, because they'll shun you, man. You'll just you just won't be spoken to, and, you know, they'll just, and comics will be blunt with you, man. It's like living in a city where every comic is Joe Rogan.
Right.
Yeah, you're just going to get called out everywhere you go if you're not doing something original.
It is difficult. It's one of the hardest things about doing any kind of stand-up is that you immediately try to sound like a stand-up that you like. You know, so you just get young people that are like, what's the deal with? And you're like, really? You're gonna come up, you do that with your friends? You go, what's the deal? Supermarket is not that super. Grandma. Let's go to Guy in Peekskill. He wants to get in on some of the Hall of Fame talk. What's up, Guy?
Hey, Ron, a huge fan. Hi, Gail. Love you on the show. I got a comment about Mike Piazza. Now, I may not be the best qualified to comment on it because I've watched him catch for about 9 minutes.
Okay.
I'm a big Yankee fan. But Mike Piazza, I don't think he's not, you know, unhappy that he's not in the Hall of Fame. I think he's grateful that he's in baseball at all. I think his only in since baseball was his godfather, a man by the name of Tommy Lasorda, who tried him out at every other position and settled on catcher with him.
Well, so you're actually saying that you don't think Piazza is a good ball player?
No, not at all. I'm just saying he's not a Hall of Fame catcher. I don't even know if he was the best catcher on the Mets.
Oh, yeah, God, he's the best hitting. He's the greatest hitting catcher in the history of baseball.
Now, and when you say like the stuff like that, you got to remember Johnny Bench also played catcher. A lot of great hitters, have played catcher over the years, but their bodies wear down and they get beat up, and it's a difficult position. And Piazza was always right there at all star level throughout his career.
12 all-star games.
It's phenomenal.
Yeah. And his body like broke down. You could see his body broke down like most catchers.
Yeah.
Gradually. You know, he didn't, you know, break down after 5 years because he had to stop cycling on steroids and then he couldn't get healthy again. He just broke down gradually. They tried him at first base. He didn't like playing there. So, you know, he bounced around for a few years, put up, you know, just padded the stats. He's got to be in. I mean, people go, oh, it must be steroids. Why he put up such big numbers. But don't forget, Tommy Lasorda was his godfather. His dad built a batting cage in his backyard. Stan Musial was his batting coach when he was a kid.
Yeah, when nobody had a batting cage.
Yeah.
I mean, I had heard about Piazza before he even made it to the pros. There was because I come from the same area, and there was articles written about him. So I followed his whole career, you know, really from when he started.
And Lasorda just gave him a chance. They drafted him like the 158th round or something like that. And they still had he still had to prove himself.
Particularly at that position where you're involved in every play and you've got to know every hitter that's coming against you. And then you have to remind your fielders. I mean, it really is a quarterback position for baseball.
Yeah, even after he got drafted, he still had to go play in Mexico a bunch of times. He had to go to, you know, Iceland and Syria or wherever, you know.
Right.
He had to, like, you know, get on buses with people and make $100 a week. And, you know, he didn't just play for the, you know, he didn't just hit cleanup for the Dodgers. He had to still earn his way on the team.
And there is no there's no other sports that point out defects as fast as that sport.
Yeah.
Because you're standing up there by yourself. Everybody can see. It's not like it takes a lot of times if you're watching football, you're like, what lineman is fucking up? Which one of these guys is letting us down? A catcher, you see his arm every day. You also know that he's responsible for calling those pitches, so you can't be baseball done. It's ridiculous to act like that's a lucky position at all for anybody.
Yeah, and if you strike out, you're by yourself.
You're standing there.
Even if you're hitting 300 that year, you instantly turn into that 10-year-old kid in Little League again. You struck out, you got your head down, going back in the dugout, all the other kids are laughing at you. So yeah, you're always in the spotlight.
I'll tell you, Mike Schmidt is in the fucking Hall of Fame, considered the best third baseman of all the time, and we did nothing but boo the shit out of him in Philly.
Yeah.
He just booed the fucking shit out of that man.
548 homers.
Yeah, because it felt like there should have been a lot more. Yeah. I'm not even kidding. It just seemed like he wasn't trying to me. It just seems like if he would have got a little dirtier, pushed it, we would have loved him.
And Piazza's a metalhead, so he deserves it to be just for that.
But you can't, I mean, like you say, you don't have to. You know, a lot of times, a lot of sports people will root for their guys. But you have to recognize what is being done well. And that's a tough position that he played all those years. Matt, Detroit.
What's up, guys?
Yeah.
Hey,
I was just wanted to tag on to what, like, everybody was saying. I'm a lot happier about the results this year comparatively to the last, you know, 25, 30 years. But it kind of seems like, maybe not we're taking over, like, but, you know, people who dig metal and hard rock, they also know that the spinners could write you a good tune. They just didn't have enough hits. But I think that there's a little bit more objectivity now. So, you know, I think when Slayer gets in, because if you think of influence, record sales, touring, and all the other criteria, they certainly do qualify. But, you know, Madonna's in, and she's on the way other end of the spectrum. So I think, you know, when we come full circle, but it just seems like the Hall of Fame, and then I'll be done, is kind of looking over their shoulder going, you know, these people kind of know what they're talking about when the, you know, Rush, come on, Kiss, come on. So
you're always going to have some kind of mainstream success. You can't get around the fact that you're not just looking for the best player, but they have to have some kind of effect on people.
Well, I'm surprised Motorhead isn't in, because Lemmy's gotten so much respect over, like, the last 10 years, even from the industry. Motorhead was always that fringe band, like, oh, I don't like Motorhead, that's heavy metal. But all of a sudden, he was like, you know, he's a public figure, a celebrity now, so I'm surprised they didn't get in.
And bands that are in are all paying homage to him and all mention him when they go on stage, guy like Metallica and stuff. I want to see, I hope Slayer and the Spinners get in on the same year.
It would be very exciting.
It's going to be great.
It would be really, really exciting.
And they could do
year.
A jam together.
Yeah. I'm wondering where NWA fits into this issue.
Yeah.
I just hope that they don't hurt Chicago, you know? Keep them away from each other.
Well, they're territorial, so.
Right.
You know,
they don't have a Midwest beef, though.
That was
East Coast, West Coast.
So
there is no Midwest beef.
And really now, Cube makes family movies.
Yeah.
I mean, there is nothing. Basically, you know, Cube started off talking about killing cops.
Yeah.
And now you just see him in movies like, you kids be quiet, man. It's the funniest shit ever.
Just like kids disrespecting Ice Cube, the movie.
Well, that is funny. But, you know, Ozzy kind of became the same thing where it is almost like a family act, you know.
Oh, he was Satan back in the 80s.
You were fucking.
70s, 80s.
Yeah, you were scared. I remember the first time I fucking heard Black Sabbath. It was fucking scared the shit out of me.
Yeah.
And even that his solo career when he had the cross and the Blizzard of Oz and the cross was upside down on Diary of a Madman cover. And then he also bit the dove's head off the bat.
Yeah.
He pissed on the Alamo. I mean, he was always getting in trouble.
He's snorting ants.
Yeah. I always said, you know, when Osbournes came on, Ozzy went from being Iron Man to a man ironing.
Yeah. They just literally acted like he couldn't do anything and was in the way.
Right.
And you're like, this is the Prince of Darkness that we're talking about.
This is the guy that's made you hundreds of millions of dollars so that you could live in that beautiful home and have three people to pick up the dog shit when that, you know.
Poor Ozzy's just sitting in one corner trying to work the fucking TV.
That was always the gimmick.
Yeah, that was always it. He could never make the TV
work.
He's
so dumb.
Look at him. He's an idiot.
But that's all those band guys are like that because they're pretty much on a schedule.
Sure.
You know, when they're on a road, the bus, it's posted up where they're going to stop, when it is. This is when you eat. This is when you do this. So when they get home, they don't even know how to mail a letter. They have no idea. Yeah. They're completely clueless. They're on the road for 9 months, and then they come home like, now I got to live my life. I don't know how to do this. How do I pay bills?
Yeah, and then they'll come home, and people are like, boy, he drinks a lot, huh? And you're like, yes, that's what he's been doing, you know. But I know, even a lot of stand-ups that they get itchy if they're not moving. There's a lot of people that feel like if they're not moving, that somehow they can't breathe. So they got to keep moving from doing it for so many years. But can you imagine going out on a rock tour? And, you know, that had to be so exciting when you're 17, 18. But the fact is these guys get to do it at 60 and now 70. And it's still there for them. It's got to be a fucking crazy thing to look back on. I'm going, I didn't know this was going to work.
Yeah.
I didn't know this was going
to
happen.
And they know every trick about being on the road.
Right.
You know, they get to Poughkeepsie. They know, okay, yeah, there's a good, you know, White Castle in Poughkeepsie. We're going to hit that. But when they get home, it's like, what do I do here?
Yeah.
There's too much room in the shower. I can actually, I can shit inside. Yeah, this is good.
Where's my per diem? I went out to the store.
Honey, where's catering?
Yeah. Oh, people don't like it when I sleep right up till 7 o'clock at night. Now you're supposed to turn it around. Because you know when you get off stage, you've got that thing. I mean, that's the most alive you could possibly feel. And now that's taken away from you. It's kind of weird to be off the road for these guys.
Jim Florentine and Don Jameson are in studio. Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6, available now on iTunes. Jim's performing New Year's Eve at the Mount Airy Casino and Resort in Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania. Go to MountAiryCasino.com for tickets. And he's performing this weekend at the Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island. And Don's performing New Year's Eve at the Funny Stop in Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. Go to FunnyStop.com for tickets.
Do you guys have to count down the thing at midnight?
I got to do from 11 to midnight. They want me on the stage. Yeah, I thought it was an earlier show, but whatever, I'll do it.
They get, like, people, like, going on, it's like about five of, and you can just start hear murmuring, like, they putting up a TV for us, or what happens here? Everyone starts to get just a little nervous as you get closer to midnight.
Yeah, and it's not distracting at all when they start handing, at about 11:30, they start handing out the little plastic cups full of champagne.
Yeah. Save this for midnight.
Yeah.
I usually just apologize, like, I'm sorry you have to spend it with me, and I'm sorry to count it down, and there's no TV to watch the ball drop. I'm sorry for all of this.
In my club, we used to have to rent a fucking TV every year. We had to put it in, they'd have to see New York City and the fucking ball drop, or else people would be like, I don't really want to go.
Did this even happen?
Yeah. This doesn't feel right without that. Yeah,
The Late Show New Year's Eve is always, always a good time.
Yeah, that's just madness.
Because nobody's overindulging.
Yeah.
Everyone's paying attention.
Stanley just woke up he woke up on a gurney.
In a gurney, yeah.
And no idea of anything he was doing. Had to go back and find out from the hospital.
Yeah.
And what did you blow at?
I blew .32. I was told four times the legal limit. Yeah.
This was last year?
This was noticed 2 days ago.
Two days ago.
We had a little party with us in the iBang.com, and we were just enjoying ourselves.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Stanley's getting a little drunk. We better get an Uber for him.
Uh-huh.
And that was the last. We put him in there. We're waving. We're like, oh, we really, thank God, we're responsible people.
Yeah.
And then next morning, he wakes up, didn't know how he got there.
Wake up in the emergency room on the gurney.
Who brought you there?
Well, first off, I wake up. and my hands are covered in blood. No shit. They're fucking covered in blood. And I'm like, what the fuck just happened? Doctor, I wake up pissed drunk.
Did you think you might have murdered somebody?
I didn't know. First of all, I didn't register at first. Like, I slid my hands and my hands look dirty. Put them back. Oh, fuck. Wait a minute. This is blood. I hope it's fucking not someone else's. And then I wake up. I have a giant wound in the back of my head.
Oh.
I had to call the hospital last night to find out what happened. So I pass out drunk in front of my apartment. Someone tries to wake me up. They call an ambulance. Ambulance comes. I run away from the EMTs. Because I'm guessing. I think, like, fuck this. I'm drunk. I'm not injured. I just want to go home.
But you were home. I was
in front of my fucking house. And then as I'm running away from the EMTs, I fall, crack the fucking back of my head open. And then they finally were able to get me into the ambulance, where I then start vomiting, is what I was told. And then I wake up at 6 in the morning on whatever. What day was it? Wednesday.
Happy New Year.
Yeah.
Happy
New Year.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you for sharing that. Now, we are a self-sustaining group. It doesn't cost anything to be here. But we're going to pass the hat around and hope that you can give up to $2. And then we'll have questions about what Chris was talking about.
Oh, jeez.
Well, what was the culprit at the, you know, what was the...
Vodka.
Vodka.
It was inside an ice block. It made him very excited. Yeah. You know.
It makes it very easy to drink.
The culprit was that he wasn't paying. Yeah. It was the open bar that fucking did it.
Yeah, it's open bar. Yeah, if a cash bar, I ain't fucking drinking that much.
So when's the next time you drank?
I drank last night.
All right.
Same clothes, by the way.
Same clothes.
Hadn't showered.
Same pukey. Yeah, you're not bringing up. You wore those pukey fucking slept in clothes here.
Yeah, to work.
I think the funniest thing is that you never knew that you had a CAT scan done.
Oh,
somebody
can
look inside your body.
Yeah.
And you don't even know it.
They also told me there was a CAT scan that happened while I was passed out drunk. Or knocked unconscious. I'm not sure.
And you know
which.
How loud those fuckers are? What if you would have woke up there?
Oh my god!
This fucking cement mixer.
That's a nightmare.
Yeah, it is.
It's fucking horrible.
You just think you've been buried alive.
Oh my god.
Vodka always numbs the pain of a hematoma.
Bloody.
So you blew a .32.
Yeah,
wow.
.32.
That's what Lemmy blows when he wakes up in the morning. So that's not that bad.
All right, thank you. I'll take it.
Why did you take a breathalyzer?
Oh, no, this was from blood work. They did blood work on me, I guess. Right. Even though there's no places where there seems there's any.
They took it out of the back of your head. That was
perfect. There you go. Yeah.
They just put a fucking jelly glass up there.
We need another jar.
A rough tank.
Well, I mean, you're officially, like, when you're sleeping on the streets of New York and the EMTs are taking you somewhere.
And I'm fighting them.
Yeah.
I'm fighting them off.
You're basically a fucking homeless dude.
I was a homeless guy for about an hour. I lasted an hour as homeless.
And what I said is, I think that there's a little something still missing there, because I don't think he fell. I think he was probably tackled. If you fall, he probably would have fell forward or had it on the side of his head. I think they tackled him down.
Just started fucking punching him in my ass back there when he was moving around. Shut the fuck up, you drunk fuck!
And you know when he was laying there passed out on the street, people were walking by looking at him like fucking de Blasio.
Yeah, it's true. Like,
this homeless problem's getting worse and worse.
I like the idea that you get out of the cab and you're like, no, it's too difficult to get inside. Here's fine. Yeah. This is where I'll sleep now.
It's
this is my
enough.
New home.
That's probably what I thought. Close enough. I'm in the vicinity.
So you don't even know if you puked in the Uber car. You could have.
I could have, yeah.
So far, no charges. Because they send an additional charge. Because I actually called him the Uber. So I was waiting, trying to figure out. We were actually looking at the map. You know, they send you a map.
Yeah.
We were trying to figure out before he had called the hospital how he could have got there. Because we thought maybe something happened in the cab, and then the cab driver might have just drove him to the hospital.
Here's the thing. Your Uber bill was $54, right?
Yeah.
That guy might have fucking pulled over and had breakfast. Because that's
54?
Yeah. To go from Manhattan to Queens. And Astoria, Queens.
Yeah, which is right over the bridge.
Not even deep.
Which should have been, about $20?
If that, yeah. Tops. With no traffic?
Probably puked.
Yeah.
$34 cleaning service.
Maybe it was just a dry heave. You don't know at this point.
You can't tell.
So did the guy ever send the star thing?
I don't know. I mean, I have the option to give him, but we don't know. I don't know what he gave me.
Oh, you never know what they give you.
You can request it from Uber.
Yeah, but that's an average. I can't know what that one guy
You better just
gave me.
Join Lyft and get rid of it.
Your account's going to be suspended.
I actually got the first Uber car, and the guy just canceled it. He goes, I'm not fucking taking this guy home.
I go,
he's fine. And I would have thrown him an extra $100 and had him walk up into bed, made sure you slept on your belly. Put a bucket on you.
Is this part of the service, or is that
but
extra?
Really, do you think it was the free booze that did it to you?
It was flowing, and I wasn't like I was drinking water. I didn't really eat anything that day beforehand.
How was the SiriusXM party yesterday?
I don't know how the food gets worse every year. They literally only had roast beef sandwiches. They weren't that good, though.
How was the booze?
It was good.
Yeah,
less of a selection than years past. It was weird. It was just Bud Light.
Dude, no, where you were standing, they only put a few things out. On the other side of the room, there was plenty of those. You need an app that gets you from the Uber into your bed. You need a separate service for that part of the ride.
You know, you're fucking around here, but we can make a little money on that.
It's like a little Nana app.
Yeah, I can start fucking raising cash right now.
It's called Money. Handler.
Yeah.
Joey, were you at the SiriusXM party?
I was there. Vito and I were there for like 10 minutes because we heard there were going to be tote bags and coffee mugs.
Yeah.
And then we found out that there wasn't, so we turned around.
What was it, PBS having a fun drive? Tote bags?
Is that what?
No totes, huh?
Yeah, well, it was one of the part-time sports guys that told us that. So they're fucking liars.
Yeah.
They're fucking with you.
Hey, I'm backing you up on that. I think that they're assholes. So no one enjoyed the big party. You didn't try to go, Gail?
I didn't. I had too much shenanigans the night before. That was so crazy. I was more shaken up about what happened to Chris than he was.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess your video is down from yesterday. There was a video of him talking into it.
Oh.
And you didn't even want to see because you said you had dead eyes.
It was that shit where I was talking. I wasn't making eye contact with anyone. And it was just glassy fucking. There was nothing going on behind my brain.
It was really awful.
Was at the party?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All the girls at the party were like, did anyone check on Chris? You know, but check. I go, Chris is fucking fine. We put him in an Uber. And they're like, well, I just don't know if he drank too much and he's going to go into Kim. I'm like,
get impressed.
He's a dude. He fucking drinks like that every night. He's fine. And then he wasn't. But I slept like a baby.
I woke up all night. I knew it.
Yeah, you were a nervous wreck.
I kept waking up every, like, other hour, just being like, and I was actually saying to my man, I know he's not home. I can feel it. Like, I'm telling you.
You guys have that fucking Star Wars twin connection.
I wish you could have just had, like, an ounce less vodka and had enough sense to periscope the entire incident.
Oh, I know. So that was actually something I thought of. I was like, I'm sure maybe in the next hour or two he'll periscope. He'll be really drunk. And when I wasn't getting that alert, I knew something was wrong.
We should just put the periscope on. It was like that thing where you see bears living in their natural life. One of the bears is down.
We could have had so many people looking after him.
We couldn't have sent you home. He would have mauled you. But why didn't we send one of these guys say, you're fucking responsible for Chris to get the better, you're fired?
I would have, but the state I was in, too. Apparently, I called my roommate so that he could call me a taxi, and I found that out last night. So I was like, have to give me a taxi.
Please.
I'm too drunk.
I want to see that video you talking.
Is it on YouTube? Because I know you scoped it, right?
I scoped it. I don't know if
it's been
ripped. Yeah, I think it's gone, yeah.
Thank Christ.
Maybe the holiday party was scaled down because they just signed Howard again.
YouTube.
It's
see
on
if
YouTube.
You can find it.
Okay.
Just so that they can see it before they take off because it is dead-eyed shit.
It's really bad.
Is that the worst ever, Chris?
Yeah, that's the worst ever.
That's the worst shape ever.
I mean, I've woken up getting, I didn't get arrested. I think that would have made it worse.
If you woke up and also been cuffed to the bed.
Yeah, that would have been the worst.
I mean, I was always
your liver's missing.
I was always a blackout drunk, and even when I was a kid, my fucking dad came and got me at someone's house of the people I didn't even know. And I was sitting on their fucking couch, and I was talking to him because I'd left the funeral and got all fucked up. A friend of mine died. And my dad just comes in, and I'm like, hey, what are you doing here? He's like, come on, buddy, taking you home. Like, no one was even mad at me. You know what I mean? Because they're like, I guess he's drunk for a reason tonight. Right. But I was always fucking doing shit like that.
Wait, you went to the wrong house?
I just went up to someone's fucking house. Thought some shit was going in. I opened up the door. He came on in. What's going on? I was just a fucking blackout weirdo.
Yeah, I did that before. Like, I used to stay at this guy's house in Florida for like a couple weeks when I go down there on vacation. Then I was living down there. 3 years later, I come home drunk and I was knocking at the door at 5 a.m. Woke the whole family up and was yelling at him to let me in. I just want to go to sleep. And they're like, you don't live here.
You're Manson now, right? That's what they see you at. They see you as Charlie Manson. At the door.
I'm like, no, just let me in. I just want to go to sleep.
And that dad always, you know, when you're 15 and you didn't know how to drink and you just get way too drunk, dad always knew.
Right.
He didn't have to get out of bed and confront you at the door. He just knew when you came in. Right. And so that at 8 a.m., it was time to cut the lawn.
Right.
And there was no other time of the day that you could do it except at 8 a.m. because he just knew you were going to be hurt.
My parents literally took the thing of, well, at least he's drinking and not doing something else. Not knowing that we were able to do both.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We could do it all.
Crazy.
All right, so I guess it's not up there, Chris.
I'm not finding it, no.
Yeah, I don't know how I got the bad word on it.
He took it down.
But, yeah, the Periscope only lasts 24 hours.
24 hours, yeah, where it stays up.
And sometimes people put it up on YouTube.
YouTube probably just flagged it themselves.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
This is sad.
Good, YouTube. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, YouTube. Do me a favor.
Yeah, let's save this kid's job.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The weird thing is he actually does endorsements for that liquor company that ends with drink responsibly. That's the sad thing.
Everyone should always drink responsibly.
All right, we got to wrap this up. Always great to see you guys. You're the best.
Absolutely,
seriously.
Man. Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Jim Florentine, Don Jameson are in studio. Terrorizing Telemarketers, Volume 6, available now on iTunes. Don's performing New Year's Eve at the Funny Stop in Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. FunnyStop.com for tickets. Jim's performing this weekend at the Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island, and on New Year's Eve at the Mount Airy Casino. Go to MountAiryCasino.com for tickets. And on Twitter, it's at RealDonJameson, at Mr. Jim Florentine.
All right, that's it for us. We'll see you all again in 1974.
Ladies and gentlemen, the evening is over. We hope you all enjoyed yourselves, and we'll see you all again in 1974. Good evening!